Good evening, everyone. I'd like to call the November 3rd, 2015 meeting of the Board of Selectmen to order. I'll briefly review the agenda for tonight. We will first have our usual selectmen's liaison reports and comments, followed by public comment and the town manager's report. At 7:20, we have an agenda item to authorize MWRA debt, and the main event of the evening at 7:30 will be a public hearing on the tax classification for FY 2016. And then at 8:30, we'll be discussing the Human Relations Advisory Committee and Boards and Committee Communication Policy. We then have approval of minutes for three of our prior meetings. Do we have an executive session tonight, Bob?
No.
Okay. We can approve those minutes without any correction in open session. Without further ado, let's go to our liaison reports. We're expecting Mr. Sexton the next 20 minutes or so. So Mr. Arena will not be here tonight. Barry, you want to start?
I think the only thing I did in the last 2 weeks is read about classification. So
okay.
I'm going to say no.
That's a good use of your time. John?
Well, you know, to start off with, that was probably my biggest agenda item as well over the course of the last 2 weeks. There's a lot of material to look at and a lot to think about. But I did, earlier this evening, have a visit with some members of the Recreation Committee. They're currently hosting a kind of a, I think, a very informative open forum. And it's downstairs in the lower conference room. And what's going on is all the youth groups that are users, well, not necessarily youth groups, because, you know, tennis is included, men's softball is included, all the users of Birch Meadow have been invited to come as they're able. And they've kind of staggered the time a little bit so that they could address issues with one group before they moved into issues with other groups.
This is in regard to the master plan.
Yeah, right? It's regard to the master plan. So what they've done is they are sharing copies of the survey. Important to note that the survey around the usage of the whole Birch Meadow complex drew a 6% response, mm-hmm. which is fairly staggering when you stop to think survey. About
is it townwide or just in that neighborhood?
No, townwide. Townwide, there's a 6% return, which yeah. is a, I mean, if you get anything over 2, it's right. big. When it turns into something like a multiple of 2s, it's almost unbelievable.
That's 500 people.
And it was very interesting because some of the things that the earlier plan had called for or suggested was very low priority with the current user group. Naturally, all the youth groups, you know, have an interest. And so what they're actually doing downstairs right now, they have posed half a dozen questions on a poster board on the wall. And they're looking for everybody's feedback on those questions, like what's the biggest challenge that your group uses, you know, has? What do you need that you don't have now? How would this be a better experience? What are we doing that is counterproductive? I mean, you know, it's kind of thought-provoking questions. So they're in the middle of doing that right now, and I'm hopeful that we get some good feedback from those organizations. When I left that meeting about 10 minutes ago, Little League was there, girls softball was there, tennis was represented, and then I think they were expecting lacrosse and soccer. I mean, the whole crowd is going to be filtering through there. So I'll be interested to see how the outcome of that, and look forward to bringing back a report of what they're hearing from the user groups.
Okay, thanks, John. I just had two items, and actually several I shared this one. I attended the financial forum on the 28th of October. We reviewed income projections, and I had some other discussions with the three groups assembled, the Finance Committee, School Committee, Board of Selectmen, their library trustees there too. Also, importantly, Barry and I on Thursday the 29th went through the first round of reviewing the police chief resumes. You forgot that one.
I forgot that one.
We have
small items.
Did a down selection, and we believe we have some very competent candidates for the assessment center that will be held in December.
Late November.
November, sorry. And that's it for me. Is there any public comment on any item that is not on the agenda? Yes, Bill.
Bill Brown. Dan, what's the status on the land across from high school? Anybody know?
The sale of the Oakland Road property?
Yeah.
It's still there.
It's what?
It's still there.
I know that.
Yeah.
The school department, in conjunction with the preschool work they did a few years ago, did some kind of samples. I never saw the results. Test pits were drilled.
Oh, I can tell you the results.
And I don't know the results, but that was work that was done over the last couple of years. The engineers and town council have worked on whether any more land transfers are needed down in Cambridge at the courthouse.
Yeah.
I don't believe so, but I don't have that in writing. Okay. So, you know, it's probably just a matter of organizing the things and it's ready, last I heard. But I don't know what the results of that test
were. The reason I'm asking is you could finance a cemetery building for us for solar.
Well, I think
I'm a little selfish, but that's all right.
Hopefully we get more for it.
Well, that's all right. We'll give you the leftover.
Yeah, that will require a pretty extensive public process as to what the neighborhood does and doesn't want there.
Mm. Well,
CPDC.
It's zoned for S-15 anyway, so.
Yeah.
So I think one of the things, I think one of the reasons, Bill, that's kind of sat still for a while is there was quite a discussion about would it be used in concert with, you know, the early childhood center and so forth. And
it's only been set since 1937.
No, I realize that. But the most recent time that it's had high activity has been in the last year or so, but it's been sitting.
It turns out that consideration probably was not in order because that land was turned over in toto to the Board of Selectmen prior to that discussion.
I understand that. I'm just kind of giving you some feedback as to why I think it sat still. It is a piece of property that I think we're supposed to be selling.
Yeah.
And the other thing, Dan, is Saturday, myself and the chairman of the trustees toured the four cemeteries with the new building committee.
In costume or not in costume?
No. No Dunkin' Donuts either.
Okay.
We were going to get a tub and have them Dunkin' bodies, but, you know, okay. They seemed like a very impressive thing. We had to stand back a little bit because John Coots came up with his hammer and started knocking waste off on the building.
Oh, jeez.
Wondering what anything was going to fall down. But they spent, I say, probably 3/4 an hour Laura Hill, probably half an hour for Charles Lawn, and
yep.
Then equally as much time at Forest Glen and some Edward End. They got a lot of ideas.
Excellent. That's a good group to be working with, I think.
I think they're going to work out well. That's it for tonight.
Thank you very much. Bob, you have something to report?
A couple of things that you've mentioned I'd like to follow up on. I've been to 4 permanent building committee meetings so far, and I know they were a little slow to develop, but the quality of the volunteers is unbelievable.
Yeah.
Not only individually, but collectively, it's a really good mix. There's a construction project manager for big projects, and there's also one for small projects. So the perspectives are really good. And a small project would be, for instance, the cemetery garage at $2 million, and large would be a high school. So, you know, the group is very high quality, and they're working closely, well, on the cemetery project generally, but they're working closely with the facilities director, because they've also been tasked with taking an overview of all the buildings as well as anything that's on their plate. And Matt and I get comments from time to time about taxes in Reading. And I will say that, you know, there still is some negative sentiment out there about the library and the process that went through.
Mm-hmm.
And I will tell you the Permanent Building Committee will remove any future difficulty. You know, if there's going to be another building project, it's going to be vetted very well through the public process, I would say. And I know Barry was instrumental in starting that, so that was a good idea.
Kudos.
And many communities have a Permanent Building Committee, so it's not an unusual thing. But it's only as good as the volunteers, and in this case, you know, they're really good. I'd like to remind everyone the town meeting starts next Monday night at the high school, 7:30.
And there are caucuses for several precincts?
There is 7 o'clock meetings for empty precinct seats. I believe it will be a 2-night town meeting, so we hopefully will conclude on Thursday. The show at the high school right now is Mary Poppins, so John and Colleen are discussing whether to come in airborne and give their state of the town in the RMLD. We'll see how that goes.
Okay.
And lastly, on the Birch Meadow survey, I saw some draft results today and late last week with John Feudo. You know, the participation was almost 600 people, so it was excellent.
Mm-hmm.
There were some surprising answers to me, maybe not to others. Passive recreation and walking was a very high use, which I thought was interesting. Dog park, as an example, was very low use. Skateboard park, no interest in that.
Did you say passive rec and what else?
And walking.
And walking.
Trails, you know, okay. Passive trails, walking.
Okay.
Pickup kind of games on the...
Yeah, there was maybe two or three items that were highly interesting, two or three that were low interest, and then special interests in the middle that like certain things. But I just wanted to say that, you know, we will produce a document for the public over the next couple of weeks to summarize these results, not just put out data, but actually explain it. And I think that document, it's really important that people understand the timeline and the process, because an ad hoc group was formed several years ago by this board. They did study it. There is a master plan. It's up on the website. And it was put into the future for the capital plan to be executed. And this board, a couple of years ago, realizing that that time was getting closer, asked the Recreation Committee to update it, to look at it. Is it still relevant? And I will tell you right off the bat that $1 million of proposed former expenses are not necessary. So it's been a really worthwhile exercise. And that was just going to be shifting the fields by 15 degrees right and left field. So, you know, this committee, the rec committee, and the relook at it, if you will, has already saved, you know, quite a lot of money on something they deem to be just not necessary, in addition to the different appetites for things now. You know, if you had asked people 10, 15 years ago, Imagination Station and a playground would have been a high priority, it's not now. You know, that generation has moved on. So, you know, look forward to getting the first written analysis of the survey, which then feeds into a public process, and the rec committee will see you, I believe it's on December 15th, to discuss all this. So you'll see a summary before that.
Very good.
All the kids that played at Imagination Station are married now.
That's true.
Yeah. They have them
with
in
two
their
kids, by the way.
Yeah. They have those structures in their backyards now.
That's true.
All right. Can we just conclude liaison reports? Anything you want to add?
No, I have nothing to add this time. Sorry for my tardiness this evening.
No problem.
Can I,
John? Yes.
There was one thing I intended to mention, although it's not actually an official liaison report. The Reading High School Athletic Hall of Fame is having their every other year induction. That's going to be coming up on the 21st of November. There are still some tickets available. It's a big class, and as always, you know, it's a fun night. There's generally 300 people that are mostly, you know, focused on either living in Reading or from Reading, and celebrate kind of all the stuff that happened on the athletic fields of Reading High School. So it's going to be a big evening, and if anybody's looking for tickets, they could contact me directly. You can find me on the website, send me an email, and I'll be happy to take care of that.
Awesome. Very good. One other thing I should probably mention, there will be Veterans Day ceremonies. I believe there will be a breakfast at the Pleasant Street Center starting, I think, at 9:30, followed by ceremonies on the Common. And I think I've been tapped as a speaker, but I got to talk to Kevin about that, Kevin Bo Miller, our veterans agent. So I hope there's a good turnout for that. And with that, we'll move on to authorization of MWRA debt. Bob?
Yeah, you have a motion in your packet. There's a whole string of authorized debt that is either no interest or low interest from the MWRA to make system improvements. This is a tiny piece that became available because it's extra and something that hadn't been approved by you previously. So normally $39,000 is a small amount, but it's the tail end of what is called Phase 7 that became available through their surplus, and actually Phases 8 and 9 you've already approved. So it's somewhat of a formality, but we are not allowed to accept the money until you make this motion.
Is there a requirement we read this in full or not?
No.
Okay. You can make it as it's worded here if you want to. I don't think we need to go through the details.
Just as it's worded, you're saying?
As stated in our motion.
Yep. Read it.
Yeah.
Move that the board accepts the motion
for the MWRA.
MWA sewer bond as is written.
Yep. That's fine. Second. Any further discussion? All in favor? Vote is 4-0. Motion carries.
You got to jump to minutes.
Yeah, let's go to minutes. We have three sets of minutes, October 20th, October 6th, September 16th. Take September 16th first. Is there a motion?
Move the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes for September 16th, 2015, as amended.
That seconded?
Second.
Any comments from the board? Things that have been passed to Paul already? We all good?
I don't think I have any.
Okay. Hearing no comments, all in favor of approving the minutes September 16th? Please raise your hand. Opposed, abstaining, three, the vote.
I was not participating in any way that night. So.
3-0-1 is the vote. October 6th?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of October 6th, 2015, as amended.
That's seconded?
Second.
Comments? Okay.
Nope.
Hearing none, all in favor of the approval of the October 6th minutes. Vote is 4-0. Motion carries. October 20th?
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the minutes of October 20th, 2015, as amended.
That's seconded. Comments? All in favor? Vote is 4-0. Motion carries. Anything else you want to review with us, Bob? While we,
I think, do you have executive session?
We do have minutes from the executive
Oh, that's true,
session.
Yeah.
Move that the Board of Selectmen approve the executive session minutes of October 6, 2016, as written.
This is as written. If there are any amendments, we'll have to wait till an executive session. There will be no amendment. Okay, we will need to poll the board on this one. Mr. Berman?
Yes.
Sexton?
Yes.
Mr. Halsey?
Abstain. Wasn't present.
Mr. Hensmeyer, yes. The vote is 3-0-1 to approve the minutes. Any other reports you want to get into, Bob? Floor is yours for about 10
minutes.
Yeah,
I can give you a preview of the next few meetings because there's actually a couple interesting topics. Not that tonight won't be interesting. Your next meeting on the 17th, Chief Cormier is going to come in to discuss what I've called police department master planning. Mm-hmm. He's going to give you an update of law enforcement and what the next 5 to 10 years look like so that, quote unquote, a new chief doesn't come in and surprise you with some things. He wants to make sure you're fully up to date on things like body cameras and all the other issues. Just as an example, Los Angeles Police Department just approved body cameras and spent $7 million a year on them. So we'd be less.
A year.
Yeah.
Cheaper than lawsuits.
If Reading were to go fully to that, it would be on the order of $400,000 a year. So it's a big number. You know, and there's pluses and minuses, but he just wants to make sure, a lot of it's technology, but he wants to make sure you're up to date on law enforcement issues as you're looking out for 5 or 10 years.
Is he looking at the one where there's actually a small camera mounted on the weapon?
I don't think so.
Which records things if it's unholstered?
I don't think so. I think it's on the...
Yeah, that's kind of the next gen
of
you know, police cameras.
And they also have the ones with the fingerprints so that someone can't take an officer's gun.
Oh, the James Bond thing, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's a whole different, you know, piece of technology separate from the camera thing. But
and one of the issues that's coming up is that many other people are videoing events,
right,
and they're doing it selectively. So if you also have a video, you know, if you don't have one, you're almost shortchanging yourself at this point, which is really unfortunate that it's come to this. But so that's one of the topics I know he wants to discuss with you. On December 1st, MAPC is in to wrap up their work, and it's going to be you know, a summary of the economic development opportunities. In addition, Colleen O'Brien, the general manager of the light department, is going to come in and give an update. And that will include space needs, facilities needs for them, because they're right in one of the four priority development areas, and she's attended religiously all the different MAPC presentations. And again, we've had the most discussion probably about the RMLD area, you know, behind RMLD and near the DPW site. And then Gene will be in to go over a wide variety of economic development models, both private, quasi-private, and public. So you can review, you know, what you choose to do in the future for economic development.
This is all December 1st, right?
That's all on the 1st. December 15th, we hope to have a new police chief appointed, and the board will be asked to confirm it by charter. You have a certain amount of time to not approve it if you choose. Hopefully we'll get that done, and the chief intends to retire in early January.
So the way it would work is that you would make a...
I would make an appointment that has a certain amount of time for the board to reject, and if the board takes no action, then it's approved.
Oh, we could affirmatively approve it, yeah.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah, and I would hope you would.
Are the final interviews going to be a public?
Not determined yet. Committee hasn't worked on that, so we don't know. Typically, what has been done in the past is one candidate is brought forward in public, but that's to be determined. There's still a month worth of process to go through to narrow the field.
How many?
No.
The
word is that? No. Also on that date, the Library Building Committee will come in to give you a formal update. They had talked about that during the fall and thought, you know, construction would slow down a little around this time, so that would be the best time to really give you a comprehensive update. The last meeting I attended, broadly speaking, the project is on time, maybe slightly slow and on budget. The construction has gone a little slower for no particular reason. We were expecting to be paying out $1 million a month, and it's more like $700,000 or $800,000, so it's been a little slow. We expect it to be, the building to be complete and the library to be moved in by next September. That's the last I heard, and again, we're on budget. We've had to make some choices along the way. You know, there's not extra money, but you know, so far so good. But they'll give you a real full update on that, and that should probably take almost an hour. And then, as I mentioned, the Birch Meadow Master Plan discussion will happen the same night with the Recreation Committee. And something that I know a couple of members are working on with one of the residents is the idea of a disability commission, which many of our neighboring communities have, and Reading does not and never has had, which is kind of interesting. And then the last thing I wanted to point out, and this is something we probably should put on an agenda, is we do need to form a formal cable advisory committee, an ad hoc, well, probably ad hoc, but it could last for 3 years.
What was that, Bob?
A cable advisory committee.
Cable advisory.
Cable TV?
Yes, cable TV.
Is this to advise RCTV or to advise the vendors?
We have a contract with the two cable companies that lasts for 2 years and 12 months or 11 months from now.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
So in 3 years, you're going to have a whole new contract.
Right.
And there's a formal process in Massachusetts that allows you to have 3 years of process. So technically, you could have started it earlier this week on November 1st.
Yeah.
There's no real need to do 3 years, but you definitely want to do two or two and a half. In the past, the town has used special counsel for that, so that's an area we can discuss. I have not discussed this with Meares and Harrington. I assume they're more than capable. But we used actually a fellow who's now Stoneham's town council in the past.
This would be for any vendors that need to use the phone poles for their... I mean, we wouldn't be dealing with Dish TV or anything like that, right?
No, I don't think we would.
It wouldn't seem to be any need to get involved with
that. I don't think so, no. Right. You know, and another wrinkle, which some of you may have heard about, is the possibility that the town, in the form of RMLD, may get interested in this line of work. So that's another thing that needs to be vetted and discussed.
Well, the high-speed fiber.
And our technology guy, Kevin Ferrella, went to a discussion with the RMLD chair, so he's pretty up to date on it.
Are they interested in pursuing this, the RMLD?
A member of the RMLD board is. I don't know if the whole board or the general manager is. I haven't heard. But Dave Talbot is very interested
in
it.
You said there's others there that...
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know if they've done anything formally.
I would hope they'd do some cost-vetting on that.
The idea of this committee having an extended life, I think, is really important.
Yeah.
I mean, this is not something you can figure out
right
in 3 months.
Right.
I mean,
it also has an economic development implication,
certainly,
too. I mean, what's the relationship between this cable TV advisory committee and RCTV? Is it an extension of them? Is it part of them?
No, it's very independent. In theory, they could recommend a course of action on RCTV up or down. They're supposed to be a very independent group. RCTV is a local organization,
right.
Formally in a contract for 3 more years. And, you know, this group should analyze RCTV and evaluate them and decide what they recommend. Reading is a little different than some other communities in that revenues from the cable companies come through the town's books and then go to RCTV. And we did that specifically for a reason.
Right.
Some towns, they just pay them directly, so they have no say and no input into the operation of a local
cable. It's like 95% of their budget is what comes in from...
at least,
contrast.
Yeah. Yeah, and Reading does very well. With two providers, we're providing $400,000-$500,000 a year of revenue to RCTV, so they should be putting out a good product. Hope they're listening. So I agree. It's a complex area. It's something that I know Peter and Peter Solomon, the other town council, spent a lot of time on 10 years ago. So it is something that does need to get started to be discussed this winter.
So Bob, do we have a format for that committee? In other words, do we have a description of what the expectations are?
Yeah, we can.
The kind of people we want.
Throw off the last one just so you see what it was like. I'll sit down. Ray Miaras has got town meetings for about another 2 or 3 weeks. And I'll ask his advice. Has he ever gone through this process? I'm sure the firm has. Get some best practices. Yeah, and we'll put a menu together for you.
I don't want to beat this to death, but I think, you know, it's simple for us to create an ad hoc committee. I think we should see what it's supposed to do and how it's going to be staffed, but I would suggest that we get those wheels in motion so that, because as we all know, you know, now you got to go through posting it and, you know, looking for volunteers and having the interviews and you know, I mean, if we want this thing up and running by the first of the year, we probably got to get it going. We have to engage that process probably pretty soon.
And we have a really clear, very clear sort of bullet list of the duties and what it's actually going to be doing and what.
Yeah. You know. I would suggest you spend more time amongst yourselves getting it right, if you will, before you're actually wanting a committee to exist.
Yeah.
I don't feel the need to have them until April, May, you know, next spring, as long as you set them up properly.
Yeah, I just think, I do think that there's so much, the financial implications of this are huge. You know, and so that being the case, I think, you know, the sooner we get about our end of the business, the better off we all are.
There are economic development impacts, because I was, again, talking to our technology staff running our network down Haven Street, which could offer broadband. So.
Okay.
Yes.
So, without further ado.
We need to wait another minute. It's formally for 7:30.
Apple says two.
I say minute
now. You have an Apple Watch?
I get, huh?
You have an Apple Watch?
I
get,
no.
Oh, that's it. Oh.
The MacBook.
You can introduce your board.
We close enough? No one's going to be on this.
I can read very slowly.
Let's call the hearing to order on the property tax classification. Would the secretary please read the legal notes?
To the inhabitants of the town of Reading, notice is hereby given that a public hearing will be held in accordance with the Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 369 of the Acts of 1982, on the issue of determining a residential factor and assessing the percentage of tax burden to be borne by each class of property for fiscal year 2016. The hearing will be held on Tuesday, November 3rd, 2015 at 7:30 p.m. in the Selectman's Meeting Room, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass. The five classes of property involved are residential, open space, commercial, industrial, and personal property. A copy of the proposed document regarding this topic is available in the Town Manager's Office, 16 Lowell Street, Reading, Mass., Monday, Wednesday, and Thursdays from 7:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m., Tuesdays from 7:30 a.m. to 7 p.m., and is attached to the hearing notice on the website at www.readingma.gov. All interested parties are invited to attend the hearing or may submit their comments in writing or by email prior to 6 p.m. on November 3rd, 2015 to townmanager@ci.reading.ma.us.
Thank you, Kevin. And welcome to everyone who came out tonight. Let me go over the ground rules for the hearing. We are first going to have a presentation from our assessor, Victor Santaniello. Did I get that right?
Absolutely.
Okay. We will then entertain questions and comments from the Board of Selectmen, and then I will open it up to any questions and comments from the audience. All I ask is that you clearly state your name, your address, and if you own a business in Reading, if you would like to offer that information, that will be good for the record. So without further ado, and I just want to add at the outset that the board has taken this very seriously. We've done a lot of homework on this, especially in the last couple of days. There's a lot of material we're going to be going over tonight. There may be more material that comes in. So the decision may or may not be rendered tonight. If it is not rendered tonight, it will be rendered in 2 weeks. But we'll have to see how the matter proceeds before we decide on that. Did you have your hand up, John?
Yeah, I do, Mr. Chairman, as a point of personal privilege, actually. Today, I filed some documents with our town clerk. And those documents were a disclosure to indicate that there may be the appearance of a conflict of interest or the appearance of a potential question of ethics. And I think that that is tied to the fact that I have served now for, I've been a member of the Reading and North Reading Chamber of Commerce for 6 years. I've served on their board of directors now for approximately 2 years. They are clearly taking a very strong position on one facet of our discussion tonight. We have many things to talk about and a lot to consider. And I needed to, you know, think through and take counsel about whether or not there was, in fact, a conflict for me. Personally, I don't feel that there is a conflict for me. My analysis and my opinions are tied to the town of Reading. The fact that I'm a member of the chamber of the board of directors of the Chamber of Commerce, for me, doesn't dictate what my decision is going to be. And there's probably unquestionably in the printed material that the chamber has put out, and they're doing their job. I mean, they're looking out for this, for the business owners and for the members of the chamber. And I, you know, and as a member of their board, I'm glad they're doing their job. And so somebody may have seen my name in any number of places tied to the chamber because I am on the board of directors. I do assert and have asserted in writing under pains and penalties that I feel that I do not need to recuse myself from this discussion, and I feel ready to participate in that, and that's my intention.
Thank you very much. Yes, Mr.
Just to be clear, I also spoke to town council last week, and he completely agreed that as long as Mr. Halsey filed that paperwork with the town clerk, there was no conflict.
I agree.
And I'd like to also, as was read in the hearing, I did receive one comment, which I'll make sure, an email, which will go into the record from the Goddard School opposing this. So I'll make sure that's part of the
right.
record.
I also received a communication from Attorney Chris Coleman. I think it was a phone call. I don't know if he's here tonight, but also opposing any shift in the CIP.
I received a similar phone call.
Very good. So, Victor, proceed.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. I'd like to note the presence of one of my board members, Mr. Stephen Crook, joined our board earlier this year. He's been a fine asset in addition to what it is we do, hunkered back in our office upstairs. Well, thank you again for allowing us to present our fiscal 2016 classification information. Required action by the Board of Selectmen would be a selection of a minimum residential factor, selection of an open space discount, granting of a residential exemption, or granting of a small commercial exemption. Minimum residential factor. Typically, Reading has never adopted a split tax rate. In that scenario, the minimum residential factor would be one. And it's relatively simple to figure out what the single tax rate would be. Total tax levy divided by the total value multiplied by 1,000 equals $14.51, which would be our single tax rate. This table is based on what the average single family home value is for fiscal 2016, which this year is $499,500.
Can I just stop? Is that the value as of January 1st, 2015?
Yes.
Okay.
For fiscal 16, you're correct, sir. And this table gives the anticipated estimated tax bill at various shift intervals. I just break it down at a 10, 20, 30, 40, and 50% shift interval, which 50% will be the maximum allowable shift Reading could do. And this shows the estimated bill and the estimated tax savings at those intervals, again, for the average single family value home of $499,500. This is just a history of what the average single-family assessed values and bills have done since 2003. Maybe next year I'll trim it out and only do 10 years because it's a lot of data presented up there.
So that's the aggregate value of every single-family house in that year, right?
Yes. Yep. Yep.
Actually, it might be good to keep those 2 years on, 2004 and 5, for future consideration, because there was an override, I believe, that happened about 03 and 04, one an operational, one a debt exclusion, and it's important, I think, trace cause and effect there for the folks.
Sure.
Yeah.
We'll get stronger glasses, Victor.
Yeah. We'll work it out. Yeah.
Single-family home sales activity in our community. For calendar year 2015, the sales that were reviewed were 259 arm's-length transactions, with an average days on market of 54.5 and an average sale price of $492,362. For calendar year 2015, which is the basis for our calendar year, sorry.
That's right.
While you're figuring that out,
did you change this?
Feel free to take those chairs out.
My slide says
someone made me change the slide.
Going on for a while.
Okay, I didn't do it. Yeah, my columns say 13 and 14.
Calendar year 2014 should read calendar year 2013. Okay. Yeah. Sales activity. Sales activity during calendar year 2014 and not 15 is 234 sales. Days on market went down by 23%. And the average sale price went up to almost $520,000, or, 5.6%. The average commercial property value for fiscal 2016 is $1,493,100. And similar to the table I presented on single-family homes, this is what the effect of a tax shift would do for the average commercial property at that value. Some other analysis that we have run looking at this for the Board of Selectmen with a lot of the information we're going back and forth with. 22% of the total commercial value of properties valued at $1 million and under. And the median value of those properties is $407,800. So average is a relative term because you're just taking the total amount of commercial property.
Victor, is that on a chart here someplace in the material?
No, it's probably in the material that...
The three-pager that we got?
Yes.
I think it's in your packet somewhere. Yeah.
So the in that class of properties under 2 million?
Under a million.
Sort of the median is 407.
Yes.
And that represents 70% of all the commercial properties?
That represents 22%.
Of under a million?
Yep.
Of the value,
22% of the commercial tax base is valued under $1 million.
So
right, but it's the highest number of parcels, right?
Yes. That was another one that went by.
Okay.
Yes.
So it is the highest by volume, number of parcels.
Yes.
And by parcels, that's close to 70%.
Yes.
So I need to wrap my head around. So the lion's share of parcels,
mm-hmm,
is under $1 million.
Mm-hmm.
The average value of that is 407.
Median value.
Median
yeah.
value.
Yep.
And the median value of the average home in Reading is 490.
Yes.
So it's almost the same value.
Yep. Give or take 90 okay. grand. Yep.
Okay. Thank you.
So while we're on these twirling numbers, it's important for me to understand what I think I understand, and then you'll correct me where I've run off the rails. So if the average commercial property is 1.5 million, mm-hmm, let's say, that would take into consideration parcels that range probably from 20 million and up.
I happen to know this. The lowest value commercial property is like $11,000, all right?
Yep.
It's everything in the class. And the highest, I believe, off the top of my head is 23,855 because they filed.
And there's probably more than one of those.
They're, right in the
there's
same
several
ballpark.
Several of them would be my guess. So, which I guess, you know, when I think about it in terms of those numbers, I'm not an actuary, but, you know, but I'm related to one, my daughter. It makes me, when I look at average numbers and I know that we've got 11,000 and we've got 70 parcels at 400,000, and then we've got, let's say, a small handful in excess of 20 million,
mm-hmm.
the averages are...
Yeah, exactly.
They're almost, they're there because it's interesting to see,
mm-hmm.
But how somebody at 20 million is affected compared with somebody at, you know, a million is dramatically different.
Mm-hmm.
So things that we have up here are tied to an average. For lack of wall space and spreadsheet space.
Spreadsheet space, yeah, mostly. You got that right.
Okay. Just trying to be clear.
This.
Oh, that's the, yeah, that's the slide.
Yeah,
that
this gives us a breakdown of the value range of properties at certain price points. And average commercial tax bill history from 2003 to the present. Again, another nice, easy one to read up there, right? The second issue is a discount for open space. Mass General Law 59, Section 2A defines Class II open space as land which is not otherwise classified and which is not taxable under provisions of Chapter 61A or 61B. Or taxable under a permanent conservation restriction, and which is land not held for the production of income, but is maintained in an open and natural condition, and which contributes significantly to the benefit and enjoyment of the public. An exemption of up to 25% could be adopted for properties classified as Class II open space. Reading has never adopted a discount for Class II open
space.
This
is privately held land that meets those criteria.
Yes.
We don't tax ourselves.
We don't. No.
Yet.
No. No.
Yes.
No. We'll try anything.
Residential exemption. Board of Selectmen may adopt a residential exemption for all residential properties in the town that are owner-occupied. An amount of up to 20% of the average assessed value of all residential properties, including vacant land, is what's used to calculate the exemption. Adopting this at a 20% exemption would raise the residential tax rate to approximately $17.51 from $14.51. This would apply to all residential properties before the exemption, which is estimated to be, again, at 20%, $1,650 off for all owner-occupied residential properties. The estimated break-even point is $550,000 and a tax amount of $7,980.
So homes and open space value below $550,000 would receive a lessening of the tax burden.
Yes.
Those above would bear a greater burden. There would not be a greater increase in the levy as a result of this.
No.
And in no case will it include.
Same as a shift in the commercial tax rate, this is a shift within the residential class of properties born simply by that class.
That's a shift within a much bigger.
So it wouldn't impact any other commercial, industrial, or?
No.
No.
Okay. No.
Would the rate, what would happen to the, I mean, because if you did this and didn't split the rate, that tells me then that $17.51 becomes the rate for all properties.
No, just the residential, because this is restricted only to the residential class.
And so 1451, the
would be a commercial
1451
rate.
Would be the commercial, you know, investment property rate.
Right.
Right. So what you'd be doing then, essentially, if we chose to do that without changing the factor, is essentially higher assessed valued homes in Reading would be subsidizing
right.
the lower assessed.
Right. About close to 75% right. of single family right. values fall below.
But that would have no impact on the commercial or industrial rate. Those would still be paying as is.
Our rates would look funny. We'd right. have a higher residential right. rate and right. a lower
but
commercial rate.
But it would be on the full
rate.
Residential value.
But there'd be no exemption on the commercial.
Which is, I think, Winchester
so
actually does that.
It'd be 100%. So in other words, if you're at 1451 as a commercial rate under this scenario, you would be subject to 100% of your value at 1451. Is that correct?
Well, every year we try to value as close to 100% as possible.
He means with no discount.
In other words, I'm saying that the...
If you own an apartment building...
Yes.
That is not owner-occupied.
Okay.
Yep.
All right? You would be paying the $17.51. Even so it's a residential structure, your tax rate would be $17.51.
So that would apply, which are large properties in that category? Is Redding Woods one of them? A lot of apartments
Well,
there?
West Street,
Redding Woods,
Pearl Commons, Street.
Johnson Woods.
Yeah.
Johnson Woods is a lot of
Well, there's their condos. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, let's clarify that piece of the discussion.
And so we will have more to say on this, but go ahead.
Yeah, because this is very intriguing. I mean, you know, part of what's come before this board and has been part of a public and external discussion of this board is that things, you know, there's some talk that in a forecasted look at our budgets over the course of the next couple of years, what's going to happen is that Prop 2.5 is going to do what it's designed to do, which is break at, you know, somewhere between 12 and 15 years from the standpoint of being able to support the expenses of a municipality like Reading. And it becomes pretty clear when I look at those numbers that that may well in fact be the case. And the thing that is frightening about that is that I know in our town we have a lot of people, 74% of them, who would be below that break-even point. And that's important in my mind because I think one of the things that we have to think about as we think about services and schools and all of those kinds of things is that we've got to, in order to maintain the value of the real estate and maintain the services and maintain the quality of the education, all of which are tied together, we also have to be very mindful of the fact that we've got a lot of people who are living in their homes and their single biggest bill is their real estate taxes. And those people are typically people on fixed income or possibly lower than average income in Reading. And, you know, we do have the, you know, the Library Express will be arriving in their tax bill next year. And people voted for it, and that's fine. They knew it was coming. I think we have to look really hard at things that potentially have a strong opportunity to protect that class of people in this town. I think that we have, more than a moral obligation to look hard at that. And this has a very interesting look to it when you consider that.
And when Victor's done, we can bring up a table that will actually show this in some
good
detail. Let me,
What are the paper,
we had some correspondence that you'd indicated there's some paperwork that people who would be giving, if we vote this residential exemption, people would have to actually have to file some paperwork with the town and potentially with their mortgage lender.
Well,
could you expand on that
a little bit? Having lived and worked in the city of Chelsea, which is a community that has granted a residential exemption for years, the reason it works in communities like Boston, Chelsea, Cambridge is because you have a higher rate of investor-owned residential property that pay for that home ownership incentive for people to take pride in their homes and continue to live in the cities like that. To adopt it here, my department would need to send letters out to every residential structure, and the letter would basically tell them what this residential exemption is. Mm-hmm. I would have to request two forms of residency, you know, maybe a copy of income taxes, copy of excise tax, or, you know, bills, what have you. And they would also have to sign under the pains and penalties of perjury. In order to accomplish this, I would need funding, obviously, for postage and stuff
this
like that.
This is to establish if it's owner-occupied.
This is, yes.
All that paperwork.
Yep. And also, over time, man hours to process the paperwork and identify those properties.
Would that have to be done annually or just when the property changes hands?
When, after properties change hands, we would glean that information from the deed. From when you look at a deed, it would tell me where the grantee address is. Right. And if it's at the location, we would either keep the exemption going.
So you don't have to make them go through the paperwork a second time?
No, if we have doubts, we would have...
So it's a one-time deal?
One-time, highly labor-intensive deal.
Understand.
So there's a cost of doing business to get it started?
Yeah.
Okay.
The mortgage company would need to be in the loop because this might affect escrow withdrawals and that kind of thing?
Well, you're lowering the tax obligation.
Right.
And eventually, the payments that come through lockbox and what have you would catch up to that lowered amount.
Right.
And this isn't something you could consider one year and then consider taking out the other year, because people will have huge swings
we understand
in their
that.
Mortgage payments.
Barry?
Before you leave this slide, if the board adopts a residential exemption while leaving the factor unchanged, then it would look like residential tax rate would be 1751.
Yes.
And the commercial tax rate would be 1451.
Yes.
So not only, if we did this without the factor, raising the factor, not only would the higher assessed homes be subsidizing the lower assessed value homes, those homes would also be subsidizing commercial property.
No, it's only restricted to this class. Right.
But you would have a higher tax rate on residential than you would have
on
commercial.
But it's on a lower base.
Yeah, but the benefit only goes to the residential
to the lower
class.
Okay.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
So
there's no difference in money at the end of the day.
Multiplying it out.
I mean, I like
zero sum game.
I like the idea of protecting sort of homeowners that have lower assessed homes, maybe struggle to pay. But I would look at that. I'd be more in favor of looking at that if and when we ever get to an override, because then basically everybody is contributing for more services. So doing it, you know, without changing this, I think doesn't have the impact. So
Okay, we'll have more discussion.
Yeah, I'm interested in picking that discussion up with you, Barry, because I think that there's more to talk about relative to that.
So,
okay, any other questions from the board on that slide?
No. So the startup cost of this is really the onerous thing that stands in front of it. Sounds like it's, you know, a labor-intensive.
Sure, but I would say, you know, consider the communities that do it and identify your similarities.
Why do you think others have not done it? Like,
I'm unaware of largely bedroom-type communities that have a majority of owner occupancy implementing this form of tax relief.
Well, one of the things we have learned from, you know, the MAPC is that our fastest-growing population in this town are senior citizens, and that 25 years from now, that growth would be by a factor of 70%. So it's something that, you know, I think we really do need to think about. I think one of the things that's going on right now, matter of fact, the library is sponsoring it, and I've been attending it every Wednesday morning, is Aging in Place in Reading. And packed house. I mean, it's a packed house. People are there, they want, and I talk to people there, because I'm a card-carrying member and I'm allowed to go. But, you know, people that live in this town like to stay in this town. And I think what we have to be careful of is that we don't let the town run away from them. There are certain neighborhoods in Boston and Cambridge and Somerville that have actually kind of run away from the people that live there. And I think we have to be very careful of that here. These are our neighbors.
Okay, you can go ahead.
Small commercial exemption. Up to 10% of the property value for commercial properties only. No industrial, no personal property. Total property value has to be less than $1 million. Not more than 10 employees as certified by the Department of Employment and Training. One business in a building of several businesses will qualify only if all other businesses in that building qualify. The exemption goes to the real estate owner and not the business owner. So depending on the type of lease, they may or may not get the exemption directly. Less than a dozen communities in the Commonwealth have adopted this type of exemption. Shall I talk a little bit about
Yeah, could you give us the numbers of how many eligible businesses?
From the Division of Employment and Training, we receive a list for the assessors only that was approximately 218 businesses that may qualify.
Of how many total?
I don't know out of how many total businesses.
I think that's a large majority of the, by number of the businesses in Reading.
Well, what we did, and we did it in less than a day, I'd like to thank my staff, Catherine, Teresa, and Joanne for getting us through this. What we did was comb that list. We kicked out those small home-based businesses because they wouldn't qualify. They're not in a commercial structure. And then we obviously went by building value, and then we went by tenancy to see if there were any businesses. And we identified 53 possible businesses that might qualify.
Oh, 53, not 218?
No.
Okay.
218 was the starting list of businesses in Reading that meet the criteria of not more than 10 employees. Mm-hmm. That's simply the list we get from them. Of those, I believe we identified 7 that could be owner-occupied.
Just 7?
Yeah.
Okay.
So where did the 53 number come from? Explain that to me.
How did you
extrapolate that?
From that list, we applied this qualifying criteria. We eliminated ones that are residential because it's not an exemption for residential.
I didn't see owner-occupied in the criteria. Is that clearly enough?
No, it's not. I'm just saying. Because I had mentioned earlier that, you know, if it's not owner-occupied, depending on the type of lease,
they may not get it.
They may not get the exemption.
Yeah,
so it goes to the property. So let's say you have, you know, a property that has 3 businesses in it. And business A has 3 people working in it. Business B has 4 people working in it. Business C has 7 people working in it. Each one of those businesses on its own will qualify, but in aggregate, it's more than 10. Would those businesses not qualify because the aggregate number of people working in there is
the limiting factor would be the building value. If the building value is $999,900, all 3 businesses would qualify. If the building's $1,000,001, they would not qualify.
Oh, I thought.
Or
was,
if bill, or if business C had 11.
Had 11.
So let's follow the bouncing ball on this for a minute.
Then A and B would qualify as
well. All right, John Halsey.
So we know that there's a certain amount of commercial properties that are worth less than $1,000,000. Do we know what that number is? I think we ran over it once here.
70% of the properties.
Well, 70% of the properties under $1 million are at 400. But you know, this is all about. That's why I said we got to follow the bouncing ball here.
38. Am I adding that up right? 81, 57.
81 and 57. So, you know, you have 138 of 51, 57. So you have 138 businesses whose commercial structures are appraised at less than $1 million.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have, you know, roughly 40% of that are assessed above. So they wouldn't qualify for an exemption like this.
Right.
But, you know, you've got about 60% of our commercial buildings that, you know, on the surface would appear to qualify at least to that qualification of $1 million or less.
Well, actually, we have more businesses than that because our list had 218.
Right.
There could be multi businesses.
There could be a $900,000 building that's housing 3 small businesses.
But the list we receive is based on criteria set forth by the Department of Employment and Training, and it's solely a list of businesses that have reported 10 or fewer employees in the prior year. And that includes home-based businesses, things of that nature. And we come down to approximately 53 that may qualify for the exemption.
Got it.
And then we would have to, you know, contact them. And
yeah. So to Barry's point, though, the aggregate idea, I mean, if you had 3 businesses in a building that was worth $900,000 and each one of them had less than 10 employees, then that would be a qualifying building.
Yes.
Okay. So the fact that together they have 17 employees doesn't really matter.
But it's some businesses, for whatever reason, they may have three employees, but they're contractors, and therefore probably don't meet the reporting requirements to the Division of Employment and Training.
I see.
I don't get into that stuff.
Got it.
Basically take...
You can only go up with the data from the DOR.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, you can only dig so deep without actually...
But they could apply for an exemption if they could prove those folks work for them?
If they're not on the list, no, they can't.
Oh, they can't. Okay.
Okay.
Very good.
It's always the best starting point. Here's the list, Vic. Go out and hunt them down.
Okay, please continue.
Another interesting concept here.
Yep.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. Neighboring communities for fiscal year 2015. Let's see, how do we stack up with that shifty Wakefield crew? Yeah. I'm the assessor over there too, so. But I watch those people.
It's always been North Reading and Reading, there's no split.
Yep.
Yeah. This basically gives us an idea what some of our surrounding communities are doing relative to splits, average single family tax bills, the rates for the prior fiscal year. And of these communities, before it used to be Linfield, but now with that fabulous marketplace development, Reading is the only community that has a CIP sector less than 10%.
Right.
What's this one? Oh, the Middlesex League. They got a good softball team? I don't know. Communities that are closely aligned with Reading, and just listing what their shift rate was, their average tax bills, and whatnot.
Could you explain that disparity on Winchester? It looks a little funny. They have a factor of one, and yet the rates are different.
Yes, making a phone call to someone that I owed a favor to and asking him a favor.
Yeah.
In Winchester, they take advantage of Master Law Chapter 110 that allows them to put water and sewer debt on the residential rate.
Oh, this way they can tack
it on only to the residential rate, which is why their rates look different.
We talked about that. When Winchester did it, it was complicated because of Winchester Hospital. You were effectively... trying to decide, is your property tax related to your water usage? And they decided as a community they saved something like $500,000 to $700,000 of taxes by doing this. That's why they did it. Then they refigured the water rates and had different tiers to try to equivalence
it.
That's
right. And the reason why that's a question for those of you following in the room, if you look over here, the shift says 1.0, which would indicate no shift in the taxes, yet they have two different rates. It's because of how they do the debt sourcing for their water and sewer on the residential rate.
Single family. Could I ask you to back up?
Sure.
One more slide back.
More.
So I just needed to take a peek at something there.
What's interesting, what jumps out at me there is, and Linfield's a recent convert, I guess, but we have one community there, Stoneham, that is within 3% of the residential split of Reading, and yet they have a very dramatic split in their tax rate. So it's not dispositive of communities that have small commercial sectors that have a split rate. That does happen up here.
But the rate is also going to be dependent on what their estimated tax levy is, what have you.
Yeah.
That's a very interesting slide for a lot of reasons.
Yeah, I mean, that's a very telling slide for a lot of reasons. I mean, you look at, although I think Linfield had the split rate even before Market
Street. Linfield always
had
a minor split, like around, I believe it was 1.09.
Yeah, it was
not
small.
Not quite 10. Yeah. They stuck their toe in the water.
Right.
Yeah.
But you look at Stoneham, Wakefield, not Woburn because that's
more
urban. They kind of, I know Melrose is, if you go to the Melrose is on there. I mean, not only is I would expect, well, if they did it, their factors would be maybe 1.1, 1.2, because they kind of look like us. And yet, if you look at the differential in their tax rates, those are pretty, I mean, our rate for commercial and residential right now is 1451. Even if we moved to a factor of 1.2, our commercial rate would be 1741, according to your slide. That's still $5, $6, $7, $10 less per thousand
The thing that you're not looking at, though, Barry, is I would be very interested to see, for example, take a look at Woburn. Woburn has a residential tax rate of 10 and a commercial tax rate of 26.
That's because they used the max, so they went to the max.
No, I'll tell you what would be an interesting exercise is to find out how that matches up to our current ratio of businesses versus residential properties. I mean, we've got 92% of the tax base is residential in this town, and 8% is. So when you look at these, and go, why are we so? We got a higher tax rate, and so, I mean, if you applied the actual split between commercial property and residential property and layered that right next to this, it would make an interesting story, you know, turn into a very interesting novel, I will tell you that, because it's going to tell a big story. It also tells you a big story about how Reading is able to manage with a very reasonable tax rate, actual tax bill to provide what it provides. I mean, we're 15% lower on our average single-family home than North Reading, for example.
Yeah, but still.
Just in actual tax.
Well, to Wakefield, where I have some experience, it's basically about a 15% commercial tax base prior to shifting. After shifting to the max of 175, residential share drops to approximately 72-73%.
Of taxes paid.
Yes,
but not of the
tax burden.
So that first column, we said residential percentage, is that the percentage of
before shift
of just the properties
that exist, right? Mm-hmm.
So
not of the taxes paid,
but of the properties. So it's, you know, Stone and Wakefield are almost like us. I mean, not we're a little bit more heavy on the residential, but you know, it's not Woburn and it's not Burlington.
The real issue, though, despite these comparisons, is the sticker shock when you first put a split in that you hit the businesses with, and that's why the room's full tonight.
I mean, you know, there's 6,500 homeowners too.
There. Well, so, I continue to say that the split is where the real challenge is here, because if you've got 15% of your revenue base, for example, and I think you said, Victor, it was Wakefield, okay, 15% is almost double the commercial base of what we have here in Reading. So when you, I mean, the bigger that disparity gets between residential and commercial, the easier it is for everybody to swallow.
Correct.
I mean, that's correct. Really what it boils down to, because when you shift the burden, the way we're talking about potentially shifting a burden, and that burden has to be spread among 8% of the property owners, it's very different than 15% or higher in some other places. So I think these are things we have to be mindful of. I mean, I don't know that, I actually don't think that there's a silver bullet to this thing. I think you got to really look at a lot of different approaches to, you know, take care of this.
And that's why we're taking care to really drill down on this. This is not just a pro forma exercise.
No rush decision either, so.
And we get to make it every year, don't we?
By law, yes, we must make it every year.
Let's go to my just silver bullet page.
Next year.
Give me chair.
And I don't know where this list comes from. It's something I think you gave me first day, and we whittled it down a little bit here. Check it to these communities. So here's this analysis. The analysis of these communities, Reading has the third lowest average single-family tax bill of those listed. All communities except Wakefield and Milton had a shift capacity of 1.5%.
That's huge, though.
Those are communities that look more like Reading. I do Wakefield these days, but...
Hey, come on now.
And maybe Linfield. Look at the 90% residential pluses, but they're the ones that look quote unquote more like residential.
Right.
All right. Oh, yeah. This will be easy to read.
Oh, there you go. I could just leave
that. I need
friggin'
binoculars for this.
In your handout for your reading pleasure. I have no analysis for this, mostly because I couldn't fit it anywhere. And basically, just a quick review of the terms, you know, levy, levy limit, levy ceiling, all that fun stuff.
Okay. Before we open this up, I just wanted to review one other, that spreadsheet I did, Bob, on the residential exemptions. Do you have that handy there? And it's on the material tonight. It's on page 5 of the what's on your desks.
Is it this one, Dan?
Yeah, that's it.
Is it this?
Yeah, that's it. Oh, the other one. Yeah, thanks to you and your staff for helping complete this. Can we make that a little bigger, like, disappear the...
Five times bigger.
It's bigger.
Disappear the river. You gonna do that?
You're gonna lose some data if you do.
Oh, you are? Okay, don't do it then. But you can zoom. View zoom.
Need a bigger wall.
Yeah, how about this?
Might be an icon.
Bob Doubles is our IT coordinator.
Yeah. There you go. Okay. This, I put this together with data from Victor. This shows that this is regarding the residential exemption and the effect on the median valued house in each of those price ranges in Reading. So what you see, the second column has the actual count of units that meet that price category, and that's the assessed value as of January 1 of this year. And the third column is the different exemption percentages, I'm sorry, the fourth column, that you can apply. It can go up to 20%, correct?
Yes.
And there would be an effectively higher and higher tax rate because you're excluding property on each of those.
Mm-hmm.
So if you compute the taxes without the exemption, it's in the next column. And then there's a fixed exemption for all property classes that you subtract from that, and then that's your final tax. So the last two columns are the important ones, and that shows the benefits and the costs to the different categories. Now here you're seeing that for the that 350 to 450K, and there's a lot of homes in that category, 2,922. If we did a 10% split, the average homeowner would save $98 over what the tax bill would be if we didn't do this. You know, and contrast that to the $68 that we did a CIP shift of 1.1. So you're already ahead of the game there for that presumably lower income individual. And if we go to a full 20%, that jumps all the way up to $425. And I think you're going to see a lot of retirees in this band and the bands below it. And so you're going to see potentially a lot of relief there. But you know, let's go down to the other end and just illustrate some of the additional costs on the higher end homes. Let's do that 850 to 9. We pull
why don't
it down.
Go all the way to the other end.
Yeah, right up to the
we have $1 million house.
So the what you're going to see here is
an increase of 14. Yep. 1406. Is that right, Dan?
Yeah,
at 20%. Yep.
Yep. So if you look at the category of homes over 950, there are 69 of those, and the median, meaning half or more and half or less within that range, it's $1,018,000, give or take. So the impact there would be up to 9% over what the tax rate would be. So that's not insignificant on these landowners. But if you went to just a 10% in the middle of that range, it's about a 5% impact, a 10% exemption. So this is a consideration for the board if they want to take this route. I think they're going to have to mull this over a little more to see you know, which way we should go here. But it is some food for thought.
Yep.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, Barry first.
Oh. Yep. So... in thinking about this, I can understand the value of a residential property. Mm-hmm. You know, sort of, you can take an average home, right? Because, you know, there's a 4-bedroom, 2-bathroom colonial on a 1/2-acre lot. Kevin's probably got 3 of them listed right now.
Not for long.
You know, you can, right, exactly. I mean, they trade frequently. You can kind of, you know, they probably trade close to their assessed value. I mean,
it's getting better.
There's a lot of them. So, you know, we can say that there's a typical residential home. It's harder, I think, when we look at commercial property. You know, the average.
There is no average commercial.
There is no average. It was average was almost 1.5 million, yet 75% of the commercial properties weren't even worth that. So you can't use those averages. And so it almost, what happens is that the higher priced or the higher assessed properties, the Home Depot's, the REI property, you know, some of the stuff on Walker's Brook that are in that range of 2 to 10 million, right? Which is only 25 properties in the entire town.
Right.
For this conversation to make sense to me, I need to know, is that property paying, quote, its fair share? And by its fair share, I mean, we saw the disparate tax rates in all the different towns.
Mm-hmm.
If you took Jordan's, let's say, and you put it on the other side of the lake, and it's now in Wakefield.
Yeah.
Okay.
Don't even think about it.
No, I'm just saying, if it went there.
Unless you want to trade the lake.
What? Right. Actually, the lake was Reading.
Right.
So.
Way back.
So what would the taxes on those really large commercial structures be if they were in different towns? Because if we find, like, for example, on the spreadsheet that you gave us when we were asking about specific properties, you know, 60 Walker's Brook, which is, I think, the Home Depot, right now pays $324,000 of taxes. Mm-hmm. Is that the right number, right?
Yeah, I'll never figure out how to rotate this one.
Well, it's the right number based on the rate.
I think it's view.
But right. if it was across 128, they would be paying $700,000.
But the question is, how are those properties assessed in different areas? So if we looked at a like property, a Home Depot in another community, and let's say it's paying $500,000 a year in taxes, right? You know, is that the right number, right? And if that's the case, then what you have is you have a very, very small number of commercial properties skewing the way we do tax rates across all classes of properties here. And so if that's the right number, right, then we're talking about the right thing. But if that's not the right number, then basically what it informs me is that Reading could actually support economically a split tax rate, because those properties will be paying much more.
You're saying if the focus could be on the largest only to shift the
tax? No, I think he's saying if the assessment is lower than it should be, that if there was a split rate, it would actually make up the difference.
I think he just said, is Victor doing his job?
So I think the question is...
No, right. I can figure out on residential.
How does he calculate it?
Right. Yeah.
Commercial property. How does that go year in, year out?
Let me go to my Ouija board slide. Yearly, assessors send out requests for income and expense data. Mm-hmm. Commercial industrial properties, income-producing properties, are based upon the income approach to value, not on how much the business makes. You could sell widgets at $1 million a widget.
Yeah.
I want to know what that widget guy pays for rent. Mm-hmm. I want to know what his expenses are. And then we go through that and apply a capitalization rate to arrive at value. Are those values correct? You can ask the tax attorneys that regularly file, telling me they're incorrect.
Yeah.
Right, they think they're low.
Are they, for example, Home Depot? Home Depot, you're here in the audience tonight? No? Just chatting.
No?
I'll be down here soon.
No?
Yeah.
Chairman of my board, who apparently couldn't be here this evening, is the chairman and chief assessor in Watertown. He has a Home Depot, and they are similarly valued. So,
okay.
Yeah, and the other piece to it too is that a lot of the commercial properties, you know, unlike our residential, which trade, that, you know, you can see what they go for. You know, are they at their highest and best use value, and therefore assessed at the proper amount? And so, again, one of the properties you sent to us was 39 Lincoln Street, which was assessed at 566. That's a certainly wood building. Well, right. That's certainly wood building sold. And is it in process?
I don't know.
Well,
it's sold.
Right, but for some of these properties, if they're not at their highest and best use.
Yep.
Is the purchase price, the value of those properties, higher than their assessed value? Because a buyer will come in and say, you know what, I'm going to turn this into apartments, or I'm going to put money in. And so therefore, the value of class of commercial property might be under assessed, because they may not be at their highest and best use.
I think there's a lag effect.
And could sell for more than what they're actually assessed for. Unlike a home, which we know on any given day, what 54 Longview Road is really worth.
Yeah.
And so if that's the case, if we could be sure or understand the process of how commercial property is assessed, and if those assessments were higher, then we wouldn't need to be talking about rates. We would just be more comfortable. And I know you do the best with what you have and what you can. But that's a moving target that I don't understand. It's harder for me to understand the assessment of a commercial property than it is a residential property.
Okay. But sure.
Well, with residential properties, I have boatloads of data on sales. Mm-hmm. And we review those sales, make changes to those sales, inspect those sales, and use those sales to value the rest of the housing stock. Commercial property is a little bit trickier.
Right.
Because commercial sales may be subject to other factors. You can have, I don't know, a huge apartment complex sell for $60 million that I have assessed for $28 million. Mr. Assessor, you're not doing your job. Well, I can goose it up a little bit. However, that was a sale to a REIT, real estate investment trust.
Okay.
And the methodology in buying that building is not typical to an arm's length transaction. So that sale price is irrelevant.
That one had a related sale in Europe that was exactly the opposite. That's why. So.
So
exactly to my, it's just, it's harder to understand the assessed values of these commercial properties.
And when you own commercial properties, own a commercial apartment building, you sell it, you're out there marketing it at a 3% cap rate.
Right.
And when you come to see me, the real cap
really
rate
five or
is,
six.
You know, five or six plus tax factor plus everything.
Okay, let's, are there any other questions from the board? Because I would like to give the audience
plenty of
time to ask questions.
I do have a, I'm looking at this chart on the, I mean, there's two things that come to mind. And, you know, the two topics of the day, residents and business and commercial property owners.
You're back on the residential.
Okay. I mean, for the moment, I'm on residential, but I'm going to shift gears to the other one here in a minute.
Okay.
And with the premise in mind that I think we've got a certain obligation to look after people's ability to be able to stay in this town. I think that that's an inherent obligation that we have, and as we look at things, you know, I mean, the library bill is going to hit everybody very shortly.
This is it's in it.
It's in it. Okay.
Right.
And so they're going to see a spike, you know, and for some people that spike they won't even notice. But you know, when I look at this chart of Dan's, which keeps bringing me back to this residential exemption analysis, how many residential properties do we have in town? 9,000.
No,
8,300. 8,300. So 4,100 of those, 4,100 of those are valued at 450 or less. And my guess is.
More than that, because you're not adding what's above there.
Well, that 460, 788.
Over 5,000.
That goes up to 550.
If you go to 550, Dan, it goes well over. It goes up to 6,000. However, let's. You know, I mean, the 550 is where the thing kind of breaks even.
Yep.
So if you look at the first three blocks, which are homes at 250 to 450, at a 20% exemption rate, and I just want to simplify this. If I have a $500,000 house and I get a 20% exemption rate, that means I'm paying taxes on $300,000.
Mm-hmm. No. The exemption is fixed because it's a standard amount
of the class.
Oh, okay, so let's stay with
it. It's not 20%.
All right, let's stay with the amount.
It's a tax credit.
Let me just, can I?
Sure.
It's not 20% of your assessed value. It's 20% of a predetermined value of all the residential properties, including vacant land.
Okay.
So it's a static number.
Okay. So that number won't necessarily match up directly on a one-on-one basis, but
it won't be 20% of your value.
No, but it's going to be some number more or less based on how your value relates to the mean, I think, based on what you've just said.
At a 20% exemption, I believe it's 94,000 roughly off your value.
Okay.
For every qualifying home.
So when that happens, and let's just kind of, again, for me, I got to keep this simple because I'm not the brightest guy in the room. But somebody that's got a $450,000 home or a $408,000 home has a tax reduction of $425.
Right.
Now, I would say to you that that is probably material to somebody that has a $400,000 home that may be living on a fixed income. And if I look at an $883,000 home, there's 144 of them on average, and my taxes go up by $999, you know what? That's not going to change my life. that's not material to somebody that owns, it's not material in the same way to somebody that owns an $800,000 or $900,000 home compared with somebody that owns a $400,000 or $500,000 home. And I think we got to be mindful of this as we make our decisions going forward about the right way to do this. And you know, this a similar thing applies when we talk about small businesses. This is the reason Victor is torturing you about the qualifications here on million-dollar commercial properties and an exemption there. I mean, look, and I, you know, I'm not going to call businesses out, but I do know this: there are a handful of commercial sites that are worth $20 million and up in this town. Mm-hmm. And honestly, are they paying their fair share? They're probably so thrilled to be in Reading.
Yeah.
They can't see straight. But you know, for the person who has you know, an $800,000 piece of property and they're running a business out of it, you know, a material change of a couple thousand dollars in their taxes is not small. I mean, it can be life-changing.
I agree, John, 100%. The guy who's got the $20 million property is thrilled to be in Reading because he's paying $14.51 rather than $26 a thousand. So that's one of the reasons why.
And also
he's thrilled to be in Reading because we support our business.
Well, I guess that creates the question the last question, and I promised to be quiet for a little while. I'm not good at being quiet, but so Victor, I mean, everything you've laid out to me indicated that you're either commercial or you're residential. And if you're commercial or residential, there are a variety of things that can tweak the way that your rate is established and paid. But at the end of the day, there is nothing that is remotely close that would cure a disparity between very expensive commercial properties and everyday commercial properties.
We can't do this kind of gradation with the available commercial exemptions. It's not going to quite.
No, it's not going to get there.
Change.
And you and I don't. I think
it's
it would
sort
be.
Sort of a shame that the law doesn't allow it.
I'm thinking it would probably be illegal to do that.
It is now.
Yeah. And, I'd be assessing from prison. Yes. Yeah. But go on.
Well, will there be some?
Well, you know, prison's not the worst place.
So you might be next to me.
Oh.
That threat's come out before.
All right. Let's. Can you take one?
Yeah. Just.
Go ahead. You got one second. Yeah, go ahead.
So. Again, Victor, this is the stuff you gave us was great. I mean, you know, we could have had this conversation in a vacuum, and it would have gone nowhere really fast.
Right.
But you actually gave us a lot of information. So, if just looking at your, you know, sort of the if you put the tax bill history, 2003 to the present, if we did nothing, just basically we voted the same way we voted last year, and the year before was basically to keep the factors the same. You're estimating that the average residential tax bill, and again, average, I know it's hard because we're doing over large numbers of properties, but the average residential tax bill is going to go up 6.15% this year. And the average, again, commercial is going to go up 1.5%.
Barry, what's the title of the slide you're on? They're trying to
find it. It's called Tax Bill History 2003 to Present.
Mm-hmm. So here's
so
the
yeah,
six.
So you look at that bottom yep. right corner, and then you compare it.
Yep.
You know, so if we did absolutely nothing, I just want to understand this. The average residential tax bill will go up 6.15%.
Correct.
And the average commercial tax bill would go up 1.6%.
Correct.
Yes. Okay. So if we did not change the rate, but then implemented the residential exemption.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and therefore some of the lower right. assessed properties would get a tax break, and some of the higher assessed properties of their taxes go up. If we did that without a factor,
mm-hmm.
the average tax will go up 6.15%, and if you live in a house that's worth more than 550, you're going to get tacked even more, and
correct.
We haven't added any more services.
Correct.
Okay.
Hopefully we're going to be able to hang on to the ones we have.
All right. Anything else from the board?
Yeah, real quickly. just in regards to all of this, you know, the one thing that kind of strikes me in this is the factor that we're looking at this and we're talking about real dollars out of real pockets or into real pockets of residents and businesses. You know, we always do a lot as a board. We're elected to make decisions like this on behalf of our residents. This one's a little different to me. This one is one that definitely affects, you know, dollars coming in and out of pockets of folks. I think it's a little different. I really want to hear from people that are going to be directly impacted, both positively and negatively, you know, for what their
residential exemption.
Residential exemption or even looking at just doing a different factor.
And I bet none of them are here tonight. Yeah.
You know, I did speak to a couple of homeowners in town just to throw out a blanket statement of saying, and this was to the extreme of saying if we went to a factor of 1.5, you know, that I could get the average homeowner in Reading around $330 in there, you know, that they wouldn't have to pay in taxes coming up next year. In order to do that, though, I'd have to charge the owner of 50 Walkers Brook Drive $178,000 more in taxes.
Correct.
And I just said, would you want me to do it? Not one of them said yes. You know, and
really?
So I think it's important that if we're looking at all these factors, we really need to get a community involvement in this. I'd actually like to hear from a lot more people, you know, throwing out some scenarios like that to say, is that something that interests you? Do you want me to put this money back in your wallet? But it's going to have an effect on this business owner over here,
right,
which actually could also have a big effect on what we've been trying to do as a town, which is try to make this town more attractive to economic development. And you know, those are really important factors when we're looking at this, to get more than just, you know, all the numbers together. Asking people, what do you think? Would you want me to do that? I think it's an important thing to ask.
Very quickly, final remarks.
This will be very quick.
Okay.
The analysis of do nothing, 6.5% roughly residential increase, 1.6% commercial increase. The missing link there is that the average commercial property is worth 1.5 million and the average house is worth 500,000. So the 1.6 is really three times 1.6 in money. So, I mean, you know, you really got to dig into these numbers. You can't just not, you know.
Yeah, I got to hold that here. I want to thank everyone for being very patient. We're going to take all the time we need to hear from everyone that wants to speak. Again, I would ask, state your name, your address, and if you have a business in Reading, if you want to offer that, that would be appreciated. And please address your comments to the chair. Mr. Brown.
Thank you. Bill Brown, 28 Martin Road. Yes, I am a taxpayer. Have been since 1956. I've been a resident of Reading since 1932.
Yeah.
And I'd like to stay in this town. And in what John is saying makes sense to me. On top of the tax increase, we're going to have water increases and everything else. And you say a fixed income. That is not so. We don't get a raise next year on our Social Security, but our taxes go up, so our income goes down. So I would be in favor of that 20% change, I think. And it might make me think a little differently on an override. Right now, I've still got my vote no home.
Sure. Who else would like to speak? Yes, sir.
I'm John Tedesco, Forest Street in Reading. I'm probably a minority here because I'm not a business owner, I'm a resident. But I'm concerned with this discussion on how it's going to impact possibly the Proposition 2.5 discussion next year, for next year's budget. What impact from a revenue aspect will have this discussion have? Is it revenue neutral? Is it going to bring more money to the town?
It is revenue neutral.
Revenue neutral.
But the concern of the board is that, and I think Mr. Brown just spoke to that, that if the voters do select an override as an option, and this is just future discussion at this point, it's hypothetical, we want to minimize the pain to the people that can't afford an increase. And we hope, you know,
and more
part
of those,
of
as you said earlier, aging in this town, more of us are going to be retiring or are retired, so it's going to have more of an impact. You keep mentioning about you're looking for economic development in Reading, yet I point to Marketplace, where a small number of residents in this town control the future of the town by not allowing that to be built in Reading.
Okay.
So that's not something that was, you know, very good for the town to allow more housing.
But we did get something in its place that is tax producing.
Yeah, but not to the extent of the commercial base, which is what we're talking about here.
Well, and you know, that was a different
board. Let's not litigate that tonight, but is there anything else like that? Okay, thank you very much. Yes, sir.
I'm Andrew Schultz. I'm on the board of directors for the Reading North Reading Chamber of Commerce. I'm not sure where to start here. The chamber, speaking for the chamber, we're certainly against a split tax rate, and there's a myriad of reasons, and I don't want to go all night here. The short version is, let's look at Wakefield versus Reading. I think some of the selectmen stated pretty comparable towns, and I would agree with that assertion. You're looking at a $12.70 difference in the commercial tax rate right now. Somebody, some small average Joe buying a $500,000 building, it's $6,355 a year more in taxes in Wakefield than it is in Reading right now. Well, where are they going to buy that building? They're going to buy it in Reading. Now, this is supposed to be a revenue-neutral plan, which I agree, but it's not revenue-neutral. Why? If we do a split tax rate, what's going to happen to commercial property values when they're sold? They're going to be depressed. The same building is much less in Wakefield than it is in Reading because of the taxes that the owner has to pay each year. That's going to drive the comps down. That's going to drive the values down, which is going to drive the assessments down, which is going to generate less revenue for the town. Moreover, any type of plan that talks about if you're less than 10 employees, if you're under $1 million, that's just going to stifle job growth. I mean, look at Obamacare. Companies aren't hiring over that threshold because they don't want to reach the threshold where they're going to start paying things. Also, you're going to have a situation where you're going to have parcels that subdivide, that turn into condos, so they're under $1 million each. You're going to have all kinds of games that are going to be played with assessments and with businesses. Many small businesses are just mom-and-pop organizations. Most of them have triple net leases, which means they're paying the share of the taxes. What's going to happen if you raise the taxes on these big landlords? It's going to hurt the little guy that runs a small shop on Haven, you know, that runs a small shop on Main Street. It's going to have a chilling effect on business in this town. The savings to individuals, I think, is great. I think that's certainly, it's not really in the chamber's purview, but I think that's a way you could attack the problem here. I do think you're going to have a situation, though, where a lot of these small businesses, they hire high school kids, they hire college kids, they have extra jobs. I have a nephew that works at the Pamplemousse. I mean, you have this situation. Those jobs aren't going to exist if there's an extra $1,000 a month on the overhead. That's going to cut one part-time job for all these small businesses. I could go on and on. I don't want to take the board's time, but the chamber is really against the split tax rate. We do feel it would have a chilling effect on business, and we think it would overall drive property values down, which would lower the tax base, which would actually lower the revenue to the town. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Schultz. Yes.
Mr. Carroll. Mr. Carroll, I own 601 to 607 Main Street here. I have four commercial. I have two tenants in my building who pay 60% of the lease amount that we agreed upon. 60% less. I'm sorry, they pay 60% off, so 40% less, because they just can't make it over there. There's no parking for my tenants. There's no parking for their clientele. Four of them have in their lease that they're supposed to pay taxes, a portion of the taxes. Not one of them pays it. Either that, or I throw them out and put somebody else in there who can't afford it. The one on the left, the coffee shop, has been gone. You know, every 2 or 3 years we get a new tenant in there. They can't make it.
Phil, what about Pavarotti's? Going on with that?
Pavarotti's one of them is paying, I don't wish you publicly say that, but he's paying 60% of his lease amount. You can go there and talk to him if you want, if you have the stomach to put up with him.
Not going to a good place.
He closed for 2 weeks to paint.
Oh, okay. That's what I was wondering about. Yeah. Thank you.
So there's no taxes. Two of them are paying 60% of their lease amount. It's either I put them out of business and have a vacant spot, or I renegotiate a lease. If you talk to any of the tenants in my building, we're on the poor side of town, on that side of the street, for traffic. You have a business on the right side here that closed for the season because they couldn't make it. They're better off closing than paying their employees to work and for their orange leaf ice cream or whatever, yogurt that they sell. The businesses downtown, unless you're a specialty and you're CVS, you're not making it. Believe me, you're not making it. And I feel badly as an owner, so badly, that my tenants can't make it, that I accept what they can do. Yeah. And on Saturdays, if you know most people who, if I'm out on Saturday, you'll see me out there sweeping, vacuuming, and cleaning toilets myself. I brought my tax return for, if anybody would like to see, we're not making it there. And my tenants are not making it, and I have two choices.
I play hardball with them, and I have four vacancies there. Or I can see to their problems that there's just not enough business, and I lower their rent.
Thank you. Who else would like to speak? Yes, ma'am.
We're new to town. I'm Robin Crane, Fitness Within. I just want to let you say that the triple, we pay triple net. And any increase in triple net right now would tank us because we're just turning the corner. We've been in business a year and a half. And I think you really have to think small business, yes, you're the property owner may be able to afford it, but that's going to just come to us, the business owner. And it really will impact us in a negative way.
Who else would like to speak? Yes, sir.
John Douglas with the Douglas Funeral Home. I'm in a fortunate position that I work and own a business in Reading, and I also live in Reading. So I look at it from both ways. Would I love to save a few hundred dollars on my tax bill every year? Absolutely. But on the other hand, where I own a business in town, my taxes go up $2,000-$3,000 minimum. Then all of a sudden, where does that go? It goes out to the consumer. You know, it goes out to raising my fees and raising things of that nature, which I don't want to do. I want to try to keep my fees down because I want to, you know, keep the businesses in Reading. I'm sure that's what all the businesses feel. So, I mean, it's just, I don't think it's a, I don't think we have enough business in town to support a split right now. So, that's my opinion. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
John Gagin, lived in town since 88 and also have three commercial properties in town. And I can't say feel exactly the same way. And to me, it's why is it that Reading only has 8% of its tax base from commercial? I mean, why aren't we trying to, well, split tax rate is going to drive that further down, if anything. We should be trying to raise that, attract businesses, and it just seems like it's a very difficult town to work in as a commercial business. Parking's consistently a problem. This, you know, we employ residents of the town consistently here. It's just not, I don't see Reading being looked at as a friendly place to do business. And you don't see a lot of small businesses wanting to come in, frankly. And this is just another reason why they would.
Could you elaborate on the comment that Reading's not friendly? Is it because of regulatory hurdles? Or?
Yes, primarily. Okay. And tax. I just signed a lease for one of our properties, and they refused to do triple net. They said, no, from what we've seen on the tax side, we don't want to get into that. We want a flat rate. So now I'm on the risk if those taxes go up. Thank you.
Anybody else? Yes, to the back.
Bobby Botticelli, Colonial Manor Realty, and also a resident. Unfortunately, I would get hit both ways here, with my home and with my business. And as many of you know, it's real estate. So yes, the last couple of years has been great, and there are other years that were great. But what happens when you hit a segment, and we will, be ready everybody, we will hit another one where like from 2007 to 2012, we were starving. We had to take from our personal pockets to keep the place going because there was no real estate out there. Everything crap. So what happens if the rate goes up now and okay, we can afford it, but then in 3 years, the market crashes again. A store like a Market Basket, we all have to eat, so we're all still gonna go to Market Basket. We're all still gonna go to Home Goods and probably go watch the water show at Jordan's. But you're not all gonna buy a house. You're not all gonna buy a piece of jewelry. You're not all going to do a lot of things that you do. So those types of businesses are really going to hurt in the downtime, and then that's when we'll see them go. So I wish there was some way we could effectively do this so that the big box stores and the stores that could afford it, because they're always going to have the business, would help out with this. But to hit businesses in town, you know, I sell real estate, as I said, and people don't want to come here because the first thing they say is, I have taxes. I want to get killed. The houses, the businesses, well, you know what? They don't get killed. That's why the big businesses are here. So we should make them more equal with other towns and keep the small business owners and property not getting slaughtered.
Bobby, may I ask if you have a thought on the residential exemption that we talked about? Is that viable for Reading?
Well, when you spoke, Dan, well, whoever spoke and said that a house over $800,000 can afford it, that's not really true at all. because we have homes. Pardon me?
I didn't say that.
I know, John did. I didn't want to figure up my money.
I'm a big target, Bobby. Don't worry.
There are homes in town that are worth 800 and more, with elderly living in them that paid $17,000 for it at some point. And as was said, they want to age in place. Because they own that property, because they happen to be on the right lot, because they happen to have the right Victorian or Colonial, doesn't mean that they have oodles of money. It means they may just be making it. And as Bill said, those on Social Security, forget that, it's coming down. So, you know, they're not getting an increase. But their Medicare is going up and the taxes will go up, so they're really getting a major decrease. So we can't all, you know, blanket because you own a home of 800,000 or more. It's not true. It's not true at all.
Yeah, that's some data we need to gather. I think that the age distribution, but.
Well, then we can sort that.
We can get that, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, this is creating more questions than answers.
Yes, sir. Mr. Brown, is there anyone else that hasn't spoken yet before we take a second round? Okay.
There was a comment about why we aren't business friendly. Quite frankly, it's NIMBY. And that's been my 48 experience of town.
I'm with you, Bill.
Anytime you want to put something in a place in this town, oh no, I don't want it in my backyard, including Summer Avenue.
Yeah. Okay. Any other thoughts?
I can name a number of businesses that wanted to come to years in Reading over the 48 years. Mm-hmm. Most of them have been NIMBY. So look in the mirror, folks.
Well, at least the town made some correct decisions on Walker's Brook Drive about 30 years ago to allow major business to build there. Is there any further comment? All right. What's the pleasure of the board? Do you feel you have enough information? Do you want to take a little more time to digest this? Bob has told me that I won't close the hearing, but we'll keep it open in case there's more information to come in. Folks are welcome to make more comments on the 17th. But I think there's a lot of stuff for us to digest here.
I'd be in favor of continuing this into the 17th. I'm not closing. Okay.
Yeah, more heat than light. We just have a lot of stuff.
There's a lot of stuff to go through.
I'm not prepared to make the decision.
I think we've all put a lot of work into this over the course of the last 10 days. Everybody off in their own little cell trying to figure this out. And you know, as I said just a minute ago, this has been, Victor, I just want to tell you, I think your presentation was really enlightening.
Thank you.
It did create more questions than answers, unfortunately. And I don't feel prepared to vote because, we saw five different derivations, you know, of the tax rate. Yeah. Do nothing, and then boom, boom, and then A, B, C, D, you know, and so forth. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think all of us are being sensitive appropriately to the fact that this time it better be a chess game, not a checker game. Yeah. I mean, we got to get this right. And we got to not do what's expedient at the moment. We got to think about, you know, where are we going to be two or three fiscal years from now and beyond. You know, I mean, people have rightly raised the question about economic development. So I guess what I'm saying is I'm not ready to make a decision. I'd really like to have more time. Do we have the time till the 17th?
Yeah, we do. Check it with Bob.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say, in regards to the comments I made earlier, too, I really would like to hear more of what the public has to say in regards to all of this, how it really affects them.
So let's let that be a plea to the public to weigh in. You can send emails to the selectmen, to Bob. You can call us. Just let us know what your thoughts are. If you've got other data you want to share.
I would ask if the board would be comfortable with me reaching out to folks. I'm a member of the Reading Parents group Facebook page here, just putting out a simple question in regard to some of this information.
It's kind of a complex question.
Yeah,
it is.
It's a lot. Yeah, it's a lot. The answers will depend on the way the question's asked.
Well,
so
the complexity
maybe
comes in the answer, right? So the question can be as simple as what I phrased on a couple different ways, or putting this scale out, not
the size of the scale, but the scope of it. If, you know, if you owned a house that was worth X, would you be willing to pay more?
You have somebody from the public that's
recently. This home that owns Y wouldn't have to pay as much. It could be as simple as that and see what the answers come.
Right, Bob, and then I'll get to whoever has the question.
Bob's about to kill me and say I can't do that.
I suggest that some two members of the board can work with me to develop a question or a set of questions. Because we can also send them out electronically.
Because I'd like to get some information back from the public.
I mean, we spent, I mean, you know, because it's our job. And the town pays us to do this.
And we're paid well for it.
Yeah. To go through all this data.
I heard there's going to be a doubling of our salary.
Right. And even as a former chair of the FinCom, I still am scratching my head over this. So I think it's great to get the public's input into this, but I think it's going to be really, really difficult to kind of cull the right sort of information, because there's like a million ways to ask this question.
Right. Yeah, I think the board should carefully consider whether this is the right year to implement any particular feature. Will it make more sense to wait a year, do some things now, other things later?
Maybe establish another committee to look at this?
I love the governance. Let's establish another committee.
Everybody take a look at that committee's report. That's your assignment.
It's funny, Mr. Chairman, if I could. I actually was at the presentation when the last ad hoc classification. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that they, and this was I think 2006 or 2007.
2007.
And one of their biggest recommendations was that we should reconvene in 5 years and look at this again.
Yeah.
Well, we're about 4 years late.
But
at least now it's kind of time has gone by, conditions have changed. You know, what about that report? What about the economic conditions and the factors of town have changed? What are similar? And is there anything in there that would, you know, lead us down one path or another? And I think enough time has gone by where we can use that as a benchmark, you know, to kind of, and then just sort of look at it from there.
I sometimes committees are a way of dodging ownership, and I don't want to be doing that as a board. I think we're into this pretty deeply as a board right now.
The committee process is strong, though, and it doesn't need to.
It has other points of view.
I think that's what you were saying more than anything. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but
trying to get some feedback. Yeah. You know, in the next 2 weeks, we can certainly come together and get some feedback from the public in regards to this.
I mean,
if we had a year feedback, we may be able to drill that feedback down a little deeper.
Who had their hand up? Yes, gentleman on the right. Yes. Could you identify yourself, please?
Charlie Gray.
Yep.
Would it be possible to have workshops with us? We could meet in small groups and with one or two of you at a time and go over, you know, instead of having a public meet, just go over our concerns and stuff, get some input, like Kevin's going to do with some of the residents. You know, kind of like one-on-one or a small group and get a feel for it.
Sure.
I
don't know if we'll be able to do that in the next 2 weeks. We do have to render a decision by law in 2 weeks.
Right.
If we do decide to defer some activities, I think that would be a splendid idea.
Yeah, I think majority of people like that.
Okay.
That's why we're all here tonight.
Yep. Duly noted.
I'd like to offer to the board, you know, after we go through this classification go-around, at any time in the spring, if you want to revisit this, we can use these numbers, dig back further into the analysis we've already produced, and perhaps start the conversation a lot earlier for fiscal 17.
Right.
Yeah.
So make myself a little
bit nice.
That
would have been nice to.
We have another hand before we continue. Yes.
Lisa. Hi, I'm Lisa Egan. I live at 8 Oak Ridge Road, and I'm a resident of Reading, obviously my address. And I also run the Chamber of Commerce. And I just wanted to say, as a resident, I moved to Reading from Boston because it had a train station. I didn't know the town well, and I'm not from Massachusetts. And my husband and I have been delighted. We love the town. We've lived here for 14 years. And the changes I've personally seen downtown with the street improvements and the restaurants and just the new business energy and just people coming into the town is awesome, and that's why I also love working for the Chamber. And my concern is that we're really on an upswing, but I feel like if we make it harder to do business in Reading by making another obstacle in terms of the split tax rate, we really could ruin what has been a tremendous amount of hard work and momentum that I feel like the town has. And I'm concerned that we're gonna really stall ourselves, or maybe look back in 5 years and say, God, when we were at this crossroad, I wish we had made this other choice. Specifically because we are only 7% commercial tax base. I think it's an undue burden for the businesses. It's just too small a percentage to ask them to carry the ball. There's very few that are large enough to absorb that kind of a incremental increase. And I think that one reason why we love Reading so much is the community. And I know working as a volunteer on behalf of my kids' schools, I could go into a business and say, would you donate a $25 gift card to my kids' preschool raffle? Would you donate one free month at your gym for my kids' playground? And I feel like people always say yes, and I know there's so many worthy causes in town, people are very passionate about them, and I love that. And I feel like if we're gonna saddle these business owners with this kind of a increase in taxes, all that's gonna dry up in a minute. And it's just gonna really change the whole community. I really feel that way. I think that we need to support our businesses, protect our business, and bring more business in so we have a bigger base to offset some of the residential taxes. I mean, I think if you ask anyone, would you like to pay less in taxes? Of course anyone's gonna say yes. I mean, that's a no-brainer. But it's such a small percentage. And I don't think that number will ever grow if we make it harder. And we additionally saddle people right when our town is just really on the upswing. You know, the town common, the town center, we're lucky to have them. There's many places that wish they had just the setup, the convenience, the location, highway access, train. I mean, we've got a lot of great things going for us, and I want to continue that. I want to see I want to see more business in town, and that's why I'm against the split tax, because I think it will impede the progress I've seen, and I've seen a lot of it.
Thanks, Lisa. Yes.
Hi, Michael Giacalone, 9 Orchard Park Drive. The question you're referring to, it is not a simple question. Look at all the discussion we've had tonight with people who kind of understand it. So there is no simple one or two sentence way to ask this question and have the average resident understand the impact and all that. With some of the things I saw up on the slides, we look at some of the surrounding towns and we say, well, this town is kind of like us. You know, they're 88% commercial based. They're kind of like us. Well, that 4 or 5% difference can be a huge gap. And when we look at, you know, I heard someone say, well, are we charging the right rate compared to this town next to us charging whatever rate they're charging? You can't compare that directly because everybody's town has a different operating budget, a different efficiency in how they're doing things, and different, I guess, overall tax bases. So I don't know if that's an accurate way to look at, well, our corporate, our commercial rate is this, their commercial rate is that. That's a correct way to do it. And in terms of having people's ability to stay in this town, you have to look at the ability to keep the existing businesses in this town as well. If those rates are going up and their taxes are going up, most of these businesses, 70% of all the parcels are under the 400,000 mark. Well, those businesses are very small businesses. $2,000 or $3,000 to those business owners can be a damaging effect. And they're going to pass those costs onto the consumers. So these very people who are looking to save $200 or $300 in their real estate taxes, if they're going to patronize the businesses in this town, are going to get that right back. And it's coming out of their pocket, you know, at least with a tax payment, they get some sort of tax break for that. You know, I came to this town because of the small commercial base. I'm for the business owners, but you know, I came from a town that was a large commercial base. If I was enjoying that town, I would have stayed there. I came to this town because of its small base, and I know there's a cost to do that. And I'm prepared, you know, I'm willing to bear that cost. So this is a very intricate analysis that's going to happen, and I'd be surprised if in 2 weeks you can really come and nail it down at that point even. This is something that takes a very long time to look at, and with the way Reading is set up, I'm not so sure it's an easy answer to say, oh, just raise the split.
Thanks, Mr. Giacalone. Yes, in the back.
Larry Hudson, I own 22 Grand Court, 2 Linden Street, 159 and 169 Haven, and 504 Main. I charge about $10 a square foot because I've been doing this for 20-something years. And you either charge nothing. If you charge the regular rate, you got a revolving door going in and out. And I was going to say something before, but I'm embarrassed. I have a tenant that hasn't paid in 6 years.
Thank you. Anybody else before we continue? Yes, Mr. Redding.
I just said, is there any way we can get copies of these slides so we can look at them?
If you, on the sign-up sheet, want to leave an email address, we'll put them up on the website. We'll put them on the website.
On the website? Okay, great, thank you.
Be happy to do that. Okay, is there a motion? We have one more. Yes?
My name's Kevin Verley. Not a resident of Reading, but my family and I own and operate the Doherty Verley Funeral Home in Reading. Reason why I'm not a resident of Reading, as Bobby said, when I was looking for real estate, taxes bumped my financing. So unfortunately, that couldn't happen, but luckily we own a business. Only thing I really want to say is looking around, I can probably name everybody in this room, what they do for work and who they are. I know them on a personal level and on a business level. I may be wrong, but I don't see anyone from Depot here or any of those big conglomerates. And I would like to say, if there's a way to find a way to tax them, that would be great.
Motion to continue the hearing until November 17th at 8:15 p.m.
So moved.
Second.
Very seconded. Okay, is there a discussion on the motion to continue the hearing? All in favor? The motion carries 4-0. We are continued until November 17th at 8:15.
Thanks for coming out, everyone.
Thank you, everybody.
You want to take a recess?
Yeah, probably take a 5 minutes.
Yeah, 5 minute break.
they're having an override. Sure, Barry, what's more water for us?
Oh.
Let's see if I have Dolan's.
They haven't had an override since 1990.
Pushing that.
I'd like to welcome the Human and Gun Relations Advisory Committee this evening. We're going to have a discussion about the HRAC and board communication policy. Bob, you want to lead off with?
Yeah, thanks. I know the human relations folks are here and have a presentation, but first I wanted to just kind of bring in front of the board something that's been in your packet probably for a month or more. There's a broader issue in addition to what these folks want to talk about, which is board and committee communication. The Board of Health chair, Andy Friedman, and John and I know him. He's a great guy. We've worked with him closely for a year. In conjunction with the board, wanted to issue a series of articles to the local press about different topics they believe to be related to health. So one of them was, I have it here behind me, health issues in college students. And he's written his own opinions and on several things. I'll read the topics just so you can see them. Depression, suicide, anxiety, eating disorders, drug abuse, and some comments in the beginning and the end. And Andy, by his own admission, he's a PhD for the Department of Environment Protection. So this is not his field, health. His health is, if you will, a secondary field or a hobby. He is not an expert at any of these things. And he acknowledges that right up front. But he believes, as the chairman of the Board of Health, and the Board of Health believes, they have an obligation to inform the community. Mm-hmm. And I think this is a broader question for the board, in addition to what you'll hear shortly, is, when a committee speaks, they are speaking for all of us. They are speaking for town government. They are speaking for you. What are the rules of engagement for anyone? And again, Andy, as a great guy, is the first one to admit he's not an expert on these topics. We have a group for our CASA, for substance abuse. Do you want the chairman of the Board of Health going out and talking about substance abuse? These are questions you really need to think about. And he puts it forward to us as a question. He believes that this will be a service to the public, but he understands that it's not his call, and the board understands that. The Board of Health and these folks are really the only groups I've come into contact with that really want to, if you will, push the envelope and issue press releases on a wide variety of topics. But we don't know that there could be other boards and committees mm-hmm. that want to engage in the same discussion. Our CASA has a board of directors. That board is not active in this sense. Our CASA, the employees, do things, but our CASA, the board of directors, where John and I are both on, do not issue press releases or have any interest in such a thing.
No.
The board of assessors have historically, occasionally issued a press release, but it's really a factually based press release. This is a tax rate. This is an explanation of something. It's not anything like an opinion. And again, Andy's the first to admit these are his opinions, but he's trying to be helpful. So I just wanted to frame the discussion that this is a broader issue, and I know the board has expressed a lot of interest, and Matt has worked with our town clerk and a few others in having a meeting of chairs and vice chairs at least. I think to have a meeting of all boards is impossible, unless you want to have three or four dates and just do the best you can in attendance. But to have a meeting of chairs and vice chairs and have them designate other people if they can't attend is more reasonable.
Maybe two such meetings with the vice chairs and chairs, so people could choose to attend one or the other.
Or they can designate someone else on the board to go.
Right.
Because of the fact that so many boards and committees, you're going to have a hard time picking a date because they all meet some night.
That's right. God forbid, it might have to be a Saturday. But
Well, if you'll remember, when we tried to have our own retreat, that's where we had to settle. It was on a Saturday morning to do it. But I think we've talked about this now. It's been like an annual agenda item, let's do this. And I do think that this is something like, what Andy's trying to do is a driver to make sure that we actually go ahead, let's pick two dates, and let's conduct, and this is, I think you need to have a series of informational meetings with the chairs and the vice chairs or their designees.
So there's a couple questions. There's a lot of topics other than just press releases that you would want to hit with these people, associate members, I know being one of them. But is this topic something you want to hit tonight? Do you want to discuss discuss some kind of coming up with, or not, a communication policy.
I think we should kick it around tonight, but this sounds like it begs a policy from the selectmen.
Yeah.
Before we have that meeting, we need to evolve a written policy.
You know, Matt, you know, I are all, you know, willing to engage in a process, but I think what is best is if it is kicked around, and if it can be hashed out with a process, you're better off than doing everything one-off.
Right.
You know, well, let's look at this today. Well, today I don't like this. Tomorrow I might.
Yeah, right.
You know, that doesn't work so well. And I know these guys have worked with some other members of the selectmen, so as they talk, you may want to expand the discussion.
Sure. Well, thank you, Bob, for that lead-in. And Linda, do you have a briefing you want to give us, or some comments or anything? Yep. You feel free to drive, or have your driver drive.
Here you go. Do you want me to do it, or do you want to do it?
I was going to.
Yeah, go ahead.
Figuredly,
let you
listen.
Okay. I'd like to introduce you. I know Chief Sagala and you are.
I'm Linda Snow-Doxer, and yes. I am both a school committee member and the chair of the Human Relations Advisory Committee. I'm the liaison to the Human Relations Advisory Committee, and this is Officer Mark Sagala.
Deputy Chief.
And
I'm Heather McLean. I'm a new member of the Human Relations.
And may I add, she is a gift that the selectmen gave to us, headed our way.
Okay.
It's been a pleasure working with Heather. Which way should I face?
Whenever you.
Whichever makes you comfortable.
You
never know where they're coming from up here. They got
yeah, exactly.
Okay, so I'll face this way. That way I don't have my back. To you. So we thank you for this opportunity to come and talk to you. We hear what you say, Mr. Butler, sorry, I'm stumbling, about the concerns of the town, and we've heard it loud and clear, and we actually really understand it from many different viewpoints, which is why we wanted to come and explain to you what we're asking for. We wanted to start this presentation off by talking a little about our mission, because thanks to RCTV, thank you RCTV, we were able to watch your discussions about the Human Relations Advisory Committee and your concerns about the mission. So we wanted to start this presentation clarifying a little bit about the way we perceive our mission, as opposed to the mission that's been published in the past, because we actually published a new one, and it's in our brochure, and it was what we used in our sunset presentation to you. And then we also wanted to talk about how we share goals, and then talk about different modes of communication and the purposes that we have, which I think will make you feel more comfortable with what our goals are, what we actually want to communicate right now. What we're not going to talk about tonight is, I know, another one of our priorities for the next 2 years, which is figuring out what our operational organization will be. We've done a little bit of the groundwork. We've looked into Melrose and Wakefield, which are both municipal organizations. And we've looked into the Winchester Multicultural Network, which is a private nonprofit. Our next steps, we want to look at more organizations, and we want to bring some of their representatives to us to talk about the pros and the cons of their organization. So we are by no means letting that stop. It's still a priority, but that's not what tonight's presentation and request is about. So the first step is looking at our mission. So last year we actually looked at our mission, and like you, from what I understand, thanks to our liaison, Kevin Sexton, we understood what some of the concerns were, and we too shared them. We were actually surprised about the difference. So I want to direct you to the highlighted items. Our goals with our committee are first and foremost proactive and positive, as opposed to, we want to create a safe place for people to come and make sure they know that they can come to us. But we want to continue the nurturing, warm, welcoming nature of the Reading community, and that's our goal. And how we want to do that is through outreach, education, making education available, even if we can't provide it. There are other organizations that are reaching out to us and letting us know about opportunities to learn about diversity and making connections within our community and across with different communities. So I want to highlight the different tone of the mission statement that we're working from. It, I hope, feels much more positive and reinforcing of what Reading is to us already, which is a welcoming, warm community that, as we heard in the last meeting, people choose to come to and live in.
You've highlighted safe place.
Yes.
Is that implying that there are unsafe situations in Reading that you're trying to put those folks out of?
No, what we're saying is we highlighted it because it's also a place where people can come and share their concerns if they have them. It's not alluding to Reading being an unsafe place. It's just a place that if they have a question, they can come to us.
Yeah.
And I will give you a concrete example of that.
That would be helpful.
So one of the goals of our recent meetings has been not just to do business per se, but also to build a core of people who share a belief that Reading is a warm, welcoming town, and to nurture that so that we know we're not alone in trying to do whatever we're trying to do in educating people and reaching out. So we've been doing some culture sharing activities as a part of our meetings. We're making it into a positive experience, strengthening our core so that as our core, we're not just preaching to the choir, we're reinforcing the choir, and we're then from there, we're going to reach out and bring our friends, bring other people that are interested. So and a concrete example is, I was, because I'm chair and because I wanted to set this example that we can be reflective practitioners. We can think about the experiences that we have, share them, and gain insight into what we've done and how we might have handled ourselves differently or the same. So I was taking a bus back from Hartford. My bus stopped in Worcester. A fellow got on. And I shared this with the committee, and the fellow that got on proceeded to make racist remarks, threatened the bus driver. The bus driver had to pull over.
Yeah.
But I was in the front seat beside him in the corner, and there was no exit for me from my bus, from my seat. And I think you can assume a little bit that I would not really like to tolerate racist remarks, and the bus was a very mixed place. So, but in that instance, I did not say, I tried to calm him down, but I did not confront the racist remarks he was saying because I did not know what he had in his bag, and I did not know he was a foot taller than me, and I did not know that it was a safe situation. So I brought this to committee and I said, I talked about how I felt in the situation. I actually felt like I had let my mission, my personal goal, priorities down because I hadn't stood up to the prejudice. But on the other hand, it wasn't a safe situation. And we were able to talk about other people that had been in those situations, brainstorm what we might have done. And then what I did do was I took down the bus number and I called the bus company afterwards and said, you might get a report on this bus driver, but here's the rest of the story.
Yeah.
And I couldn't hang out because the guy was going to follow me. He thought I was a pal.
Thank you for that.
Yeah, it really opened up the entire conversation. You know, Linda set a great example to show that anyone can come to our meetings and talk about these kinds of issues and that kind of thing.
And so it wasn't that Reading isn't a safe place, but wherever we are, we can run into these challenges, and we have to make personal decisions about how we're going to handle them. So that's one example. There might be another example where someone interpreted or misinterpreted something in town and wanted to feel it out. So we're a safe place, an intermediary, where we actually might be able to triage it so it doesn't become a big issue. People will understand individuals. It's an open meeting format. There are no secrets. So we're a place where people can figure out whether they've got an issue or whether they feel unsafe.
Yeah,
Barry. So how do you guys, I mean, I see sort of a broad mission statement. And so how do you, or do you, separate the function of, you know, educating Reading about the different cultural things that, you know, going on in town? Certainly the Martin Luther King breakfast you guys do every year is just incredible. and it's always an eye opener. You know, sort of bring people together on, you know, sort of cultural things, sort of working on diversity, and then sort of becoming sort of almost a reporting agency where someone can walk in and say, you know, a teacher in Reading High School said, you know, or I saw in the bathroom something written, or, you know, there's a group of, you know, people, you know, whatever. I'm just thinking that. So, you know, there's sort of this broad function of bringing people together and yet also a place where people can come in and say, I don't feel safe about situation A, B, and C. How do you separate those things out? Because, I mean, I see them as two separate functions. And so how do you deal with that, or what's your thinking on that?
So my thinking on that is that we are a support, a spot, a place where people can come for support, and we can triage. We're very fortunate to have a police officer on our committee.
And that's, I think, where my function comes in, because if there's anything involving law enforcement or the schools, I'll report it. You know, I'll do my due diligence to report it to the schools if it has already been reported. I can explain if it's a situation where law enforcement have been involved. At that point, I can explain our side to the person. So if the victim said they really thought they were wronged by a police officer, well, we have certain channels at work that we're going to go through to make sure that it doesn't happen. But even if it's maybe just a misunderstanding, that's where we can kind of go back and look into it. Say, hold on, just from our point, this is how it went down, just so you can see both sides at that point. So I guess that's why we're really there, is to be really involved as a from first hand pick from the police department.
The other part of that, I think, is exemplified in last spring. We did publish a press release, and it was the goal was to let people know that we exist. But the second goal, and actually a more important goal, was instructing people what to do if they did see hate in the neighborhood, because people just didn't know. So that is also related to, if someone were to come to us about something, we can educate people about what to do when they do experience something. Who do you go to? Do you erase a symbol, a racist symbol or an anti-Semitic symbol, or do you call the police, which is what you should do? Call the police so it can be documented, so that people are proactively informed as to what to do, so they don't have to worry as much about that. And then if they do come to report, then we're triaging. If it's not a police matter, then we might be able to do a community activity that raises awareness about this sensitivity. I could use an example. So,
We had a woman come one night and report something that happened several weeks earlier. Well, no one had ever called the police department to let us know, so she wondered why nothing was done. You couldn't do anything, you didn't know about it, you know?
But she disclosed it at a meeting.
Yes,
to
she
us.
Did. Correct.
Right.
So felt safe enough
to come
in that environment. To
right, and we explained, listen, next time, you know, call right away, you know, and we'll come down and take a report. If there's nothing else, we'll do everything we can to investigate what's going on, not we can really do a lot of times 2 or 3 weeks later. There's nothing, if evidence is gone by then, there's nothing we can really do with it. So
I can give another example that actually isn't from Reading. I think everybody heard about the Lynn incident, where there was pork left in a Jewish cemetery, which defiled the cemetery. And Lynn could have chosen to just clean it off and say, oh, all better. But Lynn didn't. They used it as an educational opportunity on how to show respect and how powerful disrespect is while supporting the Jewish community in Lynn. So that was a choice that was made. And if someone came into us with that and it were reported and documented, then we could make a positive experience out of a negative one. We could make it into an educational experience and thereby support the victims and let people know that it's not acceptable in our community. We can make a positive out of a negative.
Yep, well.
Just on this theme, Linda's done a nice job over the years of understanding that, you know, HRAC as a public entity or a public committee has certain rules and responsibilities, open meeting law being one of the most important ones. And in some ways, I know early on, that was really in conflict with what you would have liked to approach in terms of a safe place to report anonymously. And so that's one of the important distinctions. You know, a private entity or an individual can offer that safe anonymous haven. A public meeting can't.
Well, you can, but they have to...
Well, unless it's eligible for executive session, which they're going to have very little opportunity to.
That was our original question. We were just trying to figure out exactly what your question is.
Right.
So we've come to this sort of, this compromise that I just described.
Yeah.
When we originally asked the question, we were asking whether we could use executive session, whether our police officer could recluse himself until we figured out whether the person was comfortable with the police officer in the room, and the answer to both of those were no.
Yeah.
So then we tried to look at, well, how can our committee deal with someone coming to us? And so this is how we're dealing with it now. But again, that is related to the research that we still need to do, because Wakefield and Melrose are both municipal organizations. So we want to find out how they deal with that. And then Winchester Multicultural doesn't have to worry, but their lament is that they don't have a police officer involved, and they have to work hard to get, no offense to Winchester Police at all, but they don't have one in the room. They don't have one that they can easily ask their questions.
Well, how many voting members do you have right now?
Right now we have six. So, and we have one more opening, and then we have openings for three associate members.
You could actually have a sub-quorum meet with an individual and not have to post a meeting. That is another possibility. And I just thought of this, you know, bring that issue to the full board with, you know, Ms. X, Mr. Y came to us, if you don't want to mention it. It's a possibility that you might consider.
And that's what we were wondering about when we came to you.
We talk about things in subcommittees.
So
two only. We can't.
Two people?
Two selectmen can go off and talk to chief candidates.
Well, you could actually do
you could have three, but right? I would suggest two.
You could have three.
No. Two is better. You know, one is going to be biased potentially. Two is kind of a check and a balance.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm. You start getting to three, legally you're okay, but the perception might not be quite as good.
And that is what Winchester does. Winchester has a subcommittee that receives complaints and then triages, decides what the best route is for them.
Yeah, very.
Well, Linda, if you decide to go down the road of sort of a private nonprofit. Right. It doesn't preclude you from having a police officer on your board.
No,
right?
No, so, and we've been assured.
Right. I already made a pledge to her, talking to my boss, as of now, we would definitely absolutely have been a member of the department involved with the interval.
So did Winchester decide not to have a police officer?
No, and you know what? I would love to ask the chair's permission if we can focus, because we haven't done enough of the research yet to know what the best organization is. But what we have done is, thanks to our new member, who is an expert actually in social media and media, we've done the research on how we might safely communicate with the people that we want to know about us and engage in our events.
In the organizational structure that we're in right now.
So I'm wondering if we could continue that, and then if there are more questions about the organization, because we're absolutely working on this, and we want to find out more, but we don't know the answers to the best organizational structure yet.
Okay.
But we do have some ideas on communication. So I just wanted, this slide just points out that we share, the selectmen and the Human Relations Advisory Committee share the goal. Reading is a great place to live. We love it here. What we're looking for are ways to communicate and contribute to that wonderful community. Proactively, educationally, increasing connections, to quote Leonard Zakem, you know, getting people, helping people to know each other. So as our diversity increases, so do our connections, because that's going to happen, and I hope it happens. So we're really focusing on that proactive role, and so that's why we're here, to ask you about how we might maintain the connections that we've been making and enable people to share with the people they know to spread our message. So in terms of press releases, we have experienced, thank you, Heather. We have experienced how challenging it is with the open meeting law to publish a press release, because you really need to know what we're saying about the town. As you were saying before, we need to present a unified front, and we don't want what we're presenting, what we're publishing, to misrepresent anything. We want you to feel comfortable with what we're presenting. So working with our liaison, Mr. Sexton, we talked about having the police publish when an event happens in town, and then including a subtext, a paragraph at the end of that, just telling people what they can do if they experience something like that, a place to go to discuss it. We are a resource, and so the police will be publishing. They will know what's legal to go out there, what might compromise an investigation.
Right, so on any incident like that, we usually would publish something in the paper. If nothing else, we just give some general description of what happened. And I talked to my boss, we're in favor of the bottom paragraph. That wouldn't be an issue, throwing that on, you know, to piggyback on our regular press release that we would do anyway. You know.
And there was an example, not from Reading, but from Burlington. I think it was in today's Chronicle about, or it might have been yesterday's Chronicle. They were on top of each other on my table, about some graffiti that was written on the mosque in Burlington. And they have caught the 18-year-olds that did it. But that would be an example where we could have the police publish an update about what happened and then have us attached to that so that people know we exist in town and that our goal is to say, and we don't tolerate this in our town. That's not what Reading is about. In terms of other...
So
yes.
I have a question.
Sure.
So an incident happens and, you know, it becomes either a press release from police department, or it's part of the police blot, you know, part of the, you know, the blotter.
Yes. Yeah.
And then an addendum. What does that addendum do? Does it say what the human, you know what the committee does?
Yes.
Or does it say how that situation applies? Is it a solicitation for, I mean, I'm trying to understand what it is that will be the attachment.
So this is just an example. It's not fine-tuned yet, but it would be, the goal would be that people wouldn't feel helpless seeing an event like that happen in their town. They would know what to do with it. If they needed to talk about it, if they
to share their feelings about it, if they wanted
so,
to talk
so
about what we were going to do about
it. Would the police
it.
Department have written some kind of a press release about
yes.
the thing that just happened in Burlington?
No. Well, no. That's, they would do it in Reading. I gave the example of Burlington because they had...
No, but I'm trying to follow this, okay? So we'd have to have an occurrence in the confines of Reading that the police were made aware of. Either by report or by investigation or however you get there. You know, you get there one way or the other.
Right.
Okay?
Right.
And so they would describe what happened, and then they'd say, the next time this happens,
or they'd say,
do you
no,
call
as
us, or do you, I mean, who do you call? Ghostbusters?
I mean, I think the concluding paragraph is something like, Reading is a welcoming community that speaks out against acts of discrimination. Please be aware there's a human relations advisory committee, blah, blah, blah.
Okay. Got it.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just,
it's not
a criticism. It's just a...
I kind of know where you're going with that, John. I think to that point, you could even say, you know, if you see these occurrences, please contact the police.
Absolutely.
Yeah. But this is a resource in town as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know,
and
something along those lines.
And
so
we
they
meet every third
so there
Thursday.
So there's that distinction.
Right,
who
exactly.
do I call?
Right.
Right.
Yeah.
No,
you know,
we don't want to confuse that.
But I think that's where you were going, right?
Yeah. I think you got... I don't want our police department encouraging a diversion of the call when it should maybe be
that's
a call. Do you know what I mean?
No, I think
that is a good
suggestion. Any information about this call, hit the Bobby 7119-412. But also,
we
can have to speak about it, you know, in fields, here you go. It's where the
Okay, got it.
Thank you. It's a great question. And then in terms of if there were other press releases that might that we might be motivated, then there shouldn't be a reason why we can't go through the process with the selectmen. So we would send a copy of the draft to, as we arrange, to the town manager and to the administrative services director, and we could go through that process because we would have time. If it were an urgent matter, I think that we would all be motivated to make something happen, and so I think that we would work that out. But we're not impressing on that. What we're seeing in terms of routine things, hate is not routine in Reading, but in terms of how we would deal with something, this would be a system that would work for us if it works for you. And it leaves the control in a Reading administrative office, so the police really know what is legal to let go, to publish, and what isn't. So we're hoping that that gives you some more, a little less anxiety about that, a little more comfort with that. So the next piece, Heather is going to talk about, because this is much more her expertise.
So the next thing that we wanted to talk about was social media. This is a really great tool for a lot of different community organizations are using these days to connect with their residents and community members. What we have done in the past is use Facebook in a capacity for last year's Martin Luther King Day event. But what we'd like to do is set up a Human Relations Advisory Committee branded page that our residents and community members can like on Facebook. And some of the reasons are just that there's a lower barrier to entry for this for the community members. The previous group that we used was more of a the user experience on Facebook was that you would get things from Dr. Snow Docs, or you would get the invitation from her, not from the group itself. So this setup really enables us to have a presence in the community. Other things that it does is it conforms more to the open meeting rules. This group is totally viewable by any users of Facebook, whether they like it or not, so it's very much a public website. The followers of the site are not viewable to other followers. So in our old group, one of your concerns that we heard was that, you know, members of the group could view everybody who's in the group. And with this, it's more of a only the admins of the page can see the people who are in the group. On that note, admins are very easy to add. I've already added Matt Canales to as an admin. He's had access for a few weeks, so I think he checked it out.
Is this up net yet?
It is not public.
No.
It's unpublished.
No, no, no.
Are you planning to link it to the town website at some point?
We would love to.
Is that appropriate, Bob?
It's up to Matt. Okay. He's the lawyer.
All right.
I actually, when we get to the website page, we already have a little link that says social media on our Human Relations Advisory Committee page that's not linked to anything. So.
Reading Rec has their own page, and I find that incredibly useful.
Yeah, and I was going to say, actually, I've done some research, and Reading Trails has one as well, mm-hmm. and the Street Fair Committee, of course, has one as well. The other thing is only admins will be able to post to the page, so people can't just post onto the page themselves. We can keep that on lockdown, another concern that we had with the group. And
the other thing it controls for, after speaking with you and learning about your concern about the Facebook pages, this summer I got a bunch of requests to join. It was an event page off of my page. So it wasn't my Facebook page, but it was an event page off of that.
It was
that.
The Martin Luther King.
The Martin Luther King Day event page. I was getting requests from people who only had groups on there. I wouldn't automatically admit them because I was pretty protective of the people that were on my page. And they didn't have families, they didn't have jobs, they only had 162 groups or 100 whatever. And I was very uncomfortable with open meeting law saying no to someone that asked to become a member of that page. So it reinforced your concerns. So that's what we've tried to incorporate in this new approach to the Facebook page.
Yeah, it's an easier way to deal with spam but still stay within our open meeting laws, basically.
Yeah.
So
the way it could be used. Sorry. The way the Facebook page could be used.
Oh yes. So and really the things that we would want to obviously use this for is to grow our base of people that we can expand to reach. as well as send any events, like remind people of our monthly meetings, the Martin Luther King Day event, any other kind of events that we have throughout the year. We'll be able to post those events here. Also, we get a lot of opportunities in the community that we that are happening in other places. For example, there's a book reading happening at the Universal Unitarian Church that's very much surrounding diversity read that we would love to let people know is happening in our town. And so things like that, just to get them get that message out there to the community, I think this would be a great way to do that.
And the Winchester Multicultural Network has specifically said that whatever they plan, we are welcome to put out there so Reading residents could go. And I've been to a number of their events, and they're wonderful and they're free. And so we would grow our outreach without having to do much except be able to get the word out.
That's a very different organization from the one that you have.
Right, but we could take advantage of the programs that they are offering without charging our residents anything if
so
they're
on
interested.
This page, so is this really just a calendar?
I think it's more of a, it's kind of more of a,
with reminders.
Yeah.
Because people would get the what's going on in the committee, the events, the meetings, the agendas would be able to be on there. But people, if they liked it in the correct way, could get a reminder on there. When we uploaded something, they would get a reminder on their email that would let them know we've posted something else. So it keeps us in their psyche.
So it's a calendar.
So far.
Am I right? Is that what it is?
I guess you could describe it that way.
It's a communication vehicle for our events.
I mean, I think of it as also...
So that then begs the next question, and that is, if it's more than a calendar, then what is it? Is it an opportunity to blog? Is it an opportunity to editorialize? Is it an opportunity for the creation of a back-and-forth thread?
No.
No, that's all.
None of those. We've planned that out of it. If eventually there were articles or links that we wanted to add to that to keep people, like, I'm personally very into role models. I like learning from the choices other people have made, and there's one recently that crossed my Facebook page about a runner in 1968 who stood up for
Peter Norman, the white guy at the...
From Australia, who stood up for his black counterparts and was punished for that through his death, and only afterwards was awarded an award. And it was a very inspiring story. So on a Facebook page, eventually, once everybody's comfortable with it, we could run stories like that by you first, because we're hoping that you will be on the webpage, because it's no conversation is allowed on the page. It wouldn't be breaching open meeting law. You'd be getting information, you would not be discussing it. So we could run by Matt, who is an admin, before we posted anything. But a story, an inspiring story about a role model that shows you're not alone in making sacrifices, that would be something eventually that we could put on a Facebook page just to keep it alive in people's minds. So yes, it's starting out as a calendar because we want to go slow and make sure you're comfortable with the way we use it. Mm-hmm. Correct me if I'm wrong.
Yeah, no.
But you know, do we have a longer term view? It would be really cool to be able to put role models out there or stories about things.
I just think that
diversity.
You know, that needs to be that portion of it. If you know when you go there, I mean, that needs to be monitored. I mean, this is an advisory committee mm-hmm. to the Board of Selectmen. I mean, it's not an editorial committee. Okay, and who judges who the role model is? Is that Matt? Is that
Well,
board?
We would be putting it by Matt before we posted it.
Okay.
So it would be both. Or Kevin is our liaison, so we're hoping he would also be an admin on the page, so he would always know what's going on.
I just think it's very different than, you know, to compare it to Reading Rec, for example, which is essentially a calendar with a report of what happened. I mean, that's what the Reading Rec Facebook, you know, there was 80 kids doing this. those pictures, okay?
Well, we are comfortable starting that way. That's the way we were proposing it to start. And if we never get to the next piece, then we don't. Well, you know, we can take it one step at a time, but our goal really is to be able to keep, right now, I'm sending emails out to remind people about our meetings. It basically, it's what Laura Jem gets. You know, it's that our meeting is on that day, and I'm copying it to our liaison, to Bob and to Matt, saying that the meeting is happening on X day, here's our agenda. You've seen everything I've put out. But to be honest, it's coming from me. It's not coming from the committee. And it's multiple distribution lists for me to enter into my computer to send these emails out. And that might be a good segue to your next piece. So please, I'm not shutting down those questions because I think your concerns are important and we need to hash them out because we don't want it to be, we don't want there to be any surprises on there for the board.
And that's why we've set up the page so that there isn't that back and forth, there isn't any kind of, interaction with the public. And also, we've already made, the town employee of Matt Canales an admin of the page so that it's completely controllable. That's our goal. Until this point, the next thing that we wanted to talk about is the email outreach. So, like Linda mentioned, we have over 300 email addresses that we've gotten from the Martin Luther King Day events. We also have more that we've collected at the town fair, as well as our monthly meetings. What we'd like to do is, right now, we don't have any specific communication plan in place, and like Linda mentioned, all of our emails that we go send out to the public right now are coming from Dr. Sam Doxer on behalf of the committee. We'd really like to establish our committee as an entity and be able to keep better track of these email addresses and make sure that we're sending consistent emails that people can count on and know that they're going to get a reminder when there's a meeting happening that month. And I've done some research on free resources that are available out there. I have found one that is called MailChimp, and you can use it for free. Any organization that has 2,000 members or less, which that's a great problem to have if we ever get up to that many.
It may require formal opt-ins for the people, so that might be necessary.
I can look into that. That's a great point too, though, is that using a system like this, we could actually have an automated unsubscribe so that people could easily opt out of our emails immediately. Yep. We could also do a re-opt-in kind of thing where, like, we could take those 300 email addresses and send them out an initial email that
says,
hey, you want to still be informed of this? Yep. Yes or no, So it's a really great way to make sure people are actually getting the email that they want from us and that, those are not things that can happen when it's just from, Dr. Snow Doctor's email inbox. So this would be a good plan. And like I said, it's free, so it's always good. The next thing is just about the website. So there's some updates that I know are in progress already. We discussed the social media link that's up there that doesn't link anywhere. So hopefully if we can get our Facebook page up and running, that would be great. There's also just a couple of different links on the page, our page itself, that say things like events and reminders and things like that that don't actually have our monthly meeting even listed there. So it'd just be great to be able to have those updated so that we can make sure that when people are looking to find out when we meet and when our events are, that those are all there. Let's see. And I think that's pretty much that. The last slide is just, did I miss anything?
No, just the for the events, the posters.
So the last slide is just about just some other ideas that we had was newspapers, local media outlets like the Chronicle or the Advocate, posters, other online outlets such as Edline, being able to post just about, more of a calendar, just about our monthly meetings, our events, those kind of things. We'd really love to see. The main goal here is just to get people to come for our meetings, and get people to know that we exist as a committee and that, we're available for communication and discussion.
And this is not at all new either, because for the Martin Luther King event, we have done all of these things. We've gotten posters, we've posted them around town, we've submitted articles or press release, whatever you want to call them, about the actual event. Rob Surrett is coming, here's what's going to happen, here's who's performing, come see your neighbors. And Edline, Linda Engelson, is always willing to put out to the school community when we have an event happening. So basically, again, it is a calendar vehicle, so we can just get the word out that these opportunities are there. So I know that this just scratches the surface, but we really were hoping that you might enable us to start with our communication, because we have in 2 months, on January 18th, we have our next Martin Luther King Day event happening. We also have a tree that we're going to be doing for the Festival of Trees. So that would be a great thing to get out there as well. So we wanted to ask for your guidance, your insights, and see if we might figure out how we can get our word out. Any other questions? Great. We're very glad to answer.
Terrific. Any further questions from the board?
I mean, are you looking for us to take a formal vote? Dan, are we voting on something, or are we giving guidance, or?
Well,
we want permission.
I guess that's a better word.
Right now, we're your advisory board. We think it would be very helpful to be able to reach out to the public, to let them know of our existence, of the events that we're planning, of the events that are available through you first. We think that that would be very beneficial to our town, and we are advising you that I'll use that word.
Do you want us to so are you looking for permission to activate the Facebook page specifically?
Activate the Facebook page and get started with the email marketing,
You know something? What you're doing is spectacular. I'm trying to figure out how the square peg fits in the round hole. I mean, what you're doing, in my opinion, is honestly spectacular. I think it's a tremendous community service, and I think of all of the selectmen's advisory committees, and none of them have a logo, none of them have a marketing department. Okay, I mean, it makes me wonder if this is the right format for this spectacular work that you're doing.
Trails Committee has a web page. I don't know if they have a logo.
They have a Facebook page, too.
I got it. Yeah. I do know that.
It's not breaking precedent in that sense, John.
So our question is really what we do until we have the answers of what our best operation. Obviously, we will be, after we've done the research, we would present to you what our options are, and you would be a part of the decision as to where we go from here. But in the meantime, I guess our feeling, I think we've expressed it, is that we don't want to do nothing until we have that answer.
Right.
We've got momentum. We had over 400 people come to the Martin Luther King Day
celebration.
I'm
not questioning anything. I mean,
so we don't want to lose that momentum by doing nothing until we have a different operational
It seems like the safeguards
setup.
Are in place.
Yeah, Bob.
Yep. Especially as I work with the chair or the vice chair and or the vice chair. First, we discuss as rational human beings what the situation is and what we should do about it. And then I describe what we can or can't do because we're public sector employees with ethics and open meetings laws and all kinds of other silly rules. And that's just the way we operate. And they say, well, how do you possibly, stay in your job? That's just the fact of life of what the town government organization is. And I think John raised a really important point, which is virtually every board and committee uses social media for informational calendar purposes. Mm-hmm. So that seemed perfectly fine to me. All you're doing is what everyone else is doing, or many others is doing, is we have this event, we think you should come, it's on this day, and so forth.
Yeah. And it's a one-way communication.
As soon as you get into any kind of something that someone could call an opinion, that's different. And I know we've had a lot of discussion, and everything you've said tonight is very reasonable, and I agree with John Halsey. It's just at some point there is a line at which you have to say, okay, if we really want to do this, we have to think about our structure.
Yeah.
Logistics, meetings, perfectly fine. Perfectly
but you're
reasonable.
Doing that.
We can help you with that. We have mailing lists and so forth.
You're in the process of figuring yourselves out.
Yeah, and they'll do that, and they'll figure it out.
Yep.
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a problem with the Facebook page. I mean, the whole idea is to get more people involved. And if that gets you, those people, so then you have more people to figure out what you're going to be.
Right.
That's great. And, you know, so, and the fact that some of the precautions that you have in there, so you don't get all these crazy threads, it's a one-way communication.
Are there threads?
No, it's a one-way communication.
Like I said, the safeguards are there.
I mean, having the page kind of, in a way, sort of gives you, it's like, you don't have legitimacy until you have a Facebook page these days. So, you know, it's like, oh, you don't have a Facebook page? What are you,
and
you know?
I think, Bob, you brought up a really good point, too. As a new member, I mean, we do have very stringent ethics rules in place, and I just took an oath, and I just went through my ethics course. And, like, I think that us, as committee members, like, we understand those ethic rules, and we would not post something editorial or bloggish on this without violating those. So I think as committee members, we are, you know, we are an advisory to you. You know, we would not publish anything that we wouldn't clear with you first or make sure that it wasn't something that the entire town would be proud of.
So, Mr. Chairman.
So what are you comfortable with proposing for approval?
You know, I get the Facebook page. I get the safeguards you've put in. All of that makes sense. And as I said just a few minutes ago, the work, the mission, spectacular. I just wonder out loud, because I'm supposed to do that from this chair, if there's a real sequitur between all of this great work and being a publicly controlled advisory group. I just, you know, I'm struggling with that connection.
To be determined.
It is to be determined, but if the board would like, as we're doing research, I'm glad to send you some of the links, like Wakefield is doing it from a municipal point. And so they are actually basing themselves off of Melrose, which is also, they report to the mayor. So I'm glad to send you those links just to give you some insights. And then Winchester Multicultural Network has a webpage. So if you want to go on this journey with us, I know your plates are full, but if you need some reassurance,
tell us about it.
I'm glad to share the learning as we go along.
Don't misinterpret my question, Linda. It's not a negative question at all. It's just a
procedural.
Yeah, it's a procedural question.
Yeah, and I get it. We're not a new committee though either. So we have been operating under this
in the second
umbrella.
Life, in the second life of this committee, it went from private to public.
Well, according to my interview with Mr. Heckenblechner and Margaret Soley, it's always been an advisory committee to the selectmen.
No, that's not true.
I don't believe that's true, Linda.
Okay.
It was clergy.
It was originally
Reading
Clergy Association.
Yeah. Before they're thinking of it.
Okay. They told me 1966.
No, that was private. That was clergy.
There was no town manager in 1966,
exactly.
Was there?
Yeah. No.
Okay.
Until 86.
Oh, I know what I'm told.
Yeah.
From discussing this with other area managers and mayors, the other logistical area, which I know you're saying to say it out loud, is timeliness. The committee meets once a month. Something happens and you want to do something in social media before your next meeting. Who has the right to do that? Can the chair do it? Can one person do it? Does the whole board have to meet to do it? Those are things you should discuss also. Broadly speaking, logistics and meeting times are not a decision. They're not a deliberation. So you as the chair or anyone on the board that's doing a webcage, and I would trust Matt to make these calls. That's what he's there for. But that's another thing that, you know, you don't think of necessarily up front, and all of a sudden you're confronted with a situation where you can't get a meeting, you can't have a quorum, and you know there's something you really have to do. And that's, you know, that's, you said something about, you know, we'll all figure it out in emergency, and if it's emergency, we will.
Right, because we did grapple with that. We grappled with that around the graffiti on the swastikas on the Stoneham, right on our border at the golf course, the vandalism that was there. And we did try to publish a press release about that, but we experienced firsthand how difficult that is because of the time involved in needing a meeting. And so the compromise to that, it's not even a compromise, an alternative route to that was the role of the police publishing if something happened in Reading, whereas they might not have published it before, but this way it's published with a positive bent.
That's a good argument.
And so that sort of took care of that urgent nature.
Yeah.
Not perfectly.
Yeah.
If there were something bigger, then we would need to come to a meeting and...
Yeah, you might not be satisfied with that if, you know, you'd be really irritated that you couldn't do anything.
But there aren't many...
That helps you with a decision, though.
Right, yeah.
Right, but there aren't many of those...
Thank goodness.
Incidences in Reading right now, so in order to... start, we can work out the bugs is more what I was...
So with the way that this would work in regards to the Facebook page and things like the mass emailing, those are things that the majority of the group has to vote to do, correct? Or is that... Or do you give authority to say, you know, for postings of events and meetings...
They could say we give the authority to the secretary or whoever.
So you wouldn't actually have to get together?
So you don't have to get together on... what I would call routine matters of
information.
And we actually already did that, have a vote in the
for the Facebook. Okay. No, I just was thinking about that out loud and say, geez, that would really block you down even more.
Oh, it would. It would, but I don't think we need to do that.
Yeah. No, I mean, obviously I've worked with the group in regards to this, the Facebook page and the emailing. I think for them getting their name out there, they're two good avenues for them to do so. I think obviously going beyond that's going to involve broader discussion, probably going to involve a policy from this board for all boards and committees, quite frankly. But I think what they're doing right now and what they're proposing to do is would be great for the group.
You want to try your hand at a carefully crafted motion, given that you
I don't think you need to vote on anything.
I don't think we need to. I think
sense of the meeting's good.
Enough. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, essentially, Matt or I are the gatekeepers, so we understand.
Yeah. I mean, the safeguards are there. Philosophically speaking, we kind of all know, where everybody's marching. I think we all have much more to learn about the best way to do this, and that will be revealed over time through the research you're doing.
And come back. I mean, just when you start to sort of, figure out your organizational structure. Whether that's 3 months, 6 months from now, come back and, get our feedback and input. And
The only thing I'd add on, add on to that, since it was just an example put up tonight, I think you can change that statement for anything that goes out with the police department. Before you ever obviously do that, even throw it back to me that I can bring it to the board and we can discuss it. Not like you have to have a meeting of it. I can simply bring it up in a liaison comments and have a discussion with the board in regards to it. But I think we'd like to see that, once you got it finalized before you actually use it in publication. So
that's right. We look forward to working with you. This is community collaboration.
Doing great stuff.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Laurie.
All right.
Thank you for your time.
Thanks.
And patience.
And our new member here. That's great. Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Is there any other business that should come before the board?
Are we done?
The only thing I wanted to clarify. So, just going back from a procedural thing, is it not really worth our time in this next 2 weeks to me to really, lack of a better term, poll the public? In regards to tax classification, or do we want to just kind of hash this out more at the next meeting and see where?
Well,
what's the board's kind of will on this?
Are you voluntary to work with me on this?
I'd be happy to. Yeah,
two of us. Since you've got the.
Are you talking about the public discussion?
Yeah, just
especially on the residential exemption.
Yeah, just putting out some information and introducing and saying, what are your thoughts on it? Is it something that you'd be for, against, why?
Try to keep it simple, saying, would you be willing to benefit certain, however you want to use it, the higher property value residential people?
Yeah, and in terms of...
favor of giving relief.
And maybe not even in terms of sort of this classification discussion, but in general.
Yeah.
Right? Because, this could come up, when we, a year from now or whatever, start talking about an override, or it's got to be put into the right context. And so, I'm not sure how you can ask the question.
Well, also keep in mind, you're gonna have a double whammy if you save it all up for next year.
First, you're going to have the shift in the residential. Then you're going to have the override on top of it, all in the same tax year. That might be
Again, this is...
Something to think about.
Yeah, but in terms of Kevin's question about sort of what's the right, you know, I mean...
Well, I think the gentleman in the audience, you know, put it simply, you can't ask a simple question on a complex issue.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we can't even do it here amongst ourselves.
That has been my gotten many calls. Yeah. And my response essentially has been, this is not a simple answer.
No.
I mean, you know, if you have an hour and a half and we'll talk about it for a while. I mean, honestly, that's kind of been my response. I do think that Mr. Gray was sitting in the very back, and it was one of the last public comments.
Yep. Yep.
You know, part of the problem we have at the moment is the clock's ticking.
Yeah.
I mean, we have to make a decision on this year's tax classification on November 17th. That's just a fact.
Right. Right.
I mean, it's our legal obligation to do so, and we must. And so
to set the tax rate.
Yeah. I mean, so. And we will hash that around, talk at it, look at it, you know, maybe probably have some more questions for Bob and Victor. At least I know I will. I don't know about you guys, but. And so all that being said, we're gonna do something on November 17th.
Well, we have
if
to
it's
vote.
Nothing.
Well, it could be status quo. Yeah.
It could be, like I said, there's kind of five options that are out there on the table. Yeah. One of them is 1451. Single rate, go.
Yeah.
I mean, that is one of them.
Yep.
No matter which we do, his suggestion was we should empower some of them to have a workshop. I love that idea.
Yeah,
really. And that kind of starts to begin to satisfy what you're saying, right. Kevin.
And it also goes into the whole thing, too, as we start to poll people about what are the level of services that you want in this town. How much are you willing more? It all goes
part of it. It could be a big, broad.
You know, yeah. And it's, you know, because we have to make this decision once a year.
I think you'd have a turnout, don't you? Don't you, when you talk about
it? I think if we organize it correctly,
yeah,
I think we would. And it wouldn't be just from one sector of the community. I mean, this was, you know, mostly the chamber. I mean, obviously they had the
actually, it was mostly commercial property owners.
Commercial.
It was just about all
organized by the chamber.
Yeah. No,
actually,
so.
No.
I don't know.
I would say that a third of the people here were here because of the chamber. And I would say two-thirds of them
are used to seeing this come up on the agenda every year.
They are people that I noted that I know two things about. Property owners, commercial property owners, not members of the chamber. You know, I mean, you know, I am on their board.
Isn't that the problem with the chamber? That
no.
They're not members?
Yeah,
is that the chamber's problem?
That's a different problem.
That's
a resident's problem.
But there was
the one guy, the first guy, I think, just came up so as a resident.
One resident.
Well, two. Bill
two,
Brown.
Right?
Bill
Brown. Two resident non-business.
Oh, and Bill. Yeah. Right. There were two residents that spoke.
Did you hear Bill's comment?
That was very significant.
That's why I think you got to link these. You got to link those two together.
If you like them now, you link them that. And once you link them, you can't go back.
Well, that's why you have to be really careful about when you link.
No matter what you do, they're linked.
But you got to be timely.
It's not like we're going to link them together.
Well,
they're linked.
By opening this discussion,
it's having a discussion.
It allows for linkage or delinkage. You know, I mean, you have to open this discussion.
Yeah,
we started it 2 weeks ago.
Once. Once you do the residential exemption for the stuff I guess you can, but
you want to change the rate around. It sounds like that would be a whole other paper mill if we went from 10 to 20. Yeah.
But if you did.
Maybe not.
You and Kevin can change it. Dan and I will be long gone.
Yeah. I don't know about that. But, right. You know, the whole idea of, I mean, every year we have, it's like, you know, it's fine. I looked at you, we like laughed. We got to do this every year. Some years it's like, okay, well, you know, there's no compelling reason to look at it. And every 5 to 7 to 10 years, it becomes compelling to look at again.
Yeah.
So, you know.
Well, new status quo, whatever it is, it's a new status quo.
You have to
look at that again.
So.
It is very interesting to see how much things have changed since the last time this was looked at by a subcommittee.
Yeah.
I mean, Reading became the hot
2007, boy.
That was 2 years before that was a year before the crash.
That was a year before the crash.
So we were
in the middle of it.
Real estate was going on.
Right. Real estate leads it.
Market,
right?
Right.
So,
right.
So we were in it. So it's like, do we want to do it now? And, you know, And then the crash happens.
Downtown was being developed.
Downtown hasn't been finished yet. Now you look at it, and it's like Reading is on everybody's top 10 list. Like, where did that come from, right? I mean, partly from all the good work of people here, but the fact that, you know.
Delayed my retirement by 4 years.
People discover this.
So you and I will work with Bob on crafting something.
I would suggest we put a survey up on the website.
Is that?
With the few questions as you can get away with. But the information you get is not resolved.
No, I don't think we can engage that.
I'm not looking for.
But I need Saul to do some analytics.
You're not going to get 9,000.
I know you're not going to get all the answers.
I can join that.
He showed me.
The what?
I think I got cream.
I'm going to try to get an age breakdown by that median value of home. Like, what's the age split?
Oh, right, right.
I've got a database if I can join it.
Yeah, I know Bobby said she thinks there's a lot of 800 plus that are aging in place. I don't know if that'd be a lot.
I'm going to disprove that.
I think I would disagree with that. I would
disprove
that. They're all under 500.
Yeah, I think there are a lot of people that have $800,000 homes who don't have a lot of discretionary income in this town.
Right, that's
that, I believe.
Sure, I believe that. Yeah.
So
that's why I think it's going to be real. I mean, you know, if you're already looking at doing a residential exemption, which, as we learned tonight, is painful, to actually to make a means test out of it as well, I just think that's just an administrative nightmare that
I don't think that a means test will apply. I don't think you can do it. There is no way to do it.
I mean, you know.
And I don't think that
the law does not allow that.
I don't want to put people through hoops, but it's not uncommon. I mean, I've lived in a lot of states. It's not uncommon to have an exemption, a homeowner exemption, and then
and all you have to do is prove you live there.
Right. There's a double exemption when you hit 65.
The city of Boston does an owner occupancy exemption. Yeah. So, and you just have to live. You have to show you lived there for a year, and then they're going and they'll lower your taxes.
So,
and it's a pretty easy kind of process.
In regards to the exemption, what if people don't take it?
That's their
then that is a revenue gain for the town, correct?
It depends how they do it.
Or does it get? Or do you look at the end of the year and break it down that way?
If you don't take it.
Is that going to the overlay?
You know what I mean?
Yeah, it depends.
Okay.
The reading I did said it went into the overlay so that if they apply for it in the future, it can come back.
I mean,
they can get a retro.
So no, what happens is that those people who don't apply for it just make it more expensive for the ones who do. Oh, no, the other way around.
No, the other way around.
The other way around.
Helps off the other ones.
So
doesn't reduce the other ones.
Yeah, I don't think
what it does is it creates a surplus in a separate account.
Yeah, everybody has to apply for the exemption, whether you're getting more taxes or less, right?
Well, they don't have to. In order to get it, they do, yes. Yeah.
Well, if you don't apply for an exemption and you have a $800,000 house, you don't get the first 100, you don't get the 20% exemption, which means that, you know, your increase of $600 or $700 could it would go up, you know, exponentially by not taking the exemption. I mean, this is just it because it's a zero sum game, it's circular math.
Yeah.
Right. Well, what we discussed tonight is not gonna raise a nickel more revenue for the
town. Nope.
It's just gonna divide the pie differently.
But it may leverage the raising of a nickel.
But what it may create a platform for people who otherwise would blatantly reject the concept of an operating override, right, to say, you know what, everybody's working together on this. And, you know, maybe the best thing for all parties, you know, is to work together top to bottom and not be at odds, because everybody's being looked out for. We're looking out for the small business owner, we're looking out for the resident, and we're looking out for the welfare of the town be able to continue with services, continue its contributions to the schools.
You're not sure.
You know,
or you can shift and do both exemptions.
I will tell you the other thing that was up on that wall that needs to be, we've been saying this for 2 years. People need to understand how favorable our real estate taxes are. Yeah. They are extremely favorable comparative to, you know,
And our business tax rates are extremely favorable.
That needs to be
especially
right
for those larger plots of, I'm not going to go by name, but by the larger, you know, plots.
It's a factor, but not the only factor. I think I made this point in the meetings before, that the time to permit and business friendliness sometimes counts a whole lot more than tax to a business.
Well,
they'll pay the tax. But they want their permits.
But you know something?
Oh, absolutely, and they should. And they absolutely should. I mean,
but you know what,
we're in the customer service business.
How does our professional team streamline, speed up when we're understaffed?
That's hard to do.
I mean, this is really an issue. And it's not going to, that issue's not going to get smaller.
No.
That issue's going
to
get
and
bigger.
And this board needs to forcefully argue that point at town meeting when it's budget right. time next year.
You know what? I believe the following, that responsible people, when they're exposed to the truth, come up with good answers. And that's what, it's our job to deliver that.
And there has to be an aura of trust. I hope we help build that tonight.
Well, I think one goes hand in hand with the other.
Hell, we got applauded.
We got applauded.
Did we?
I think somebody in the audience got applauded.
Yeah, I don't want to thank God it's I'm over. Real sure that wasn't us getting applauded.
It couldn't have been.
Anyway.
If you were going to do some kind of press release or whatever, we just need to do it by Thursday. Because you're only going to have Thursday to next Wednesday to gather data or responses in order to get into your packet.
So, we should.
So, if you want to just communicate with me in the next day or two,
okay,
work something out.
All right,
very good. Anything else? Your motion.
Move the Board of Selectmen adjourn the meeting at 10:17 p.m.
Rectamundo, seconded. All in favor? You stand adjourned.
Thank you.